for water or anything, you can go on your own. Definitely, we are putting something. And after 1:15, we'll have a prasadam break. So we'll serve you lunch prasadam here. We wanted to make sure that you make it quick. 2:30, we'll begin the next seminar, which will continue till 5 o'clock, so 2.5 hours. So in that time, the next half, we might give a short break. And after that, Mataji also gives some personal association to devotees who have any questions. And tomorrow, the seminar will start at 1 p.m., just after the Rajbhog Aarti. So 1 to 3:15, we'll start mostly frequently asked questions. And then we'll have the Sunday feast program. And we're asking a small donation of $15 for the registration who did. And Vishakha Mataji is collecting. Please see her and give your name and email. There are some handouts will be supplied. That's why those emails have been registered. Only they will get those handouts after the program. And Aruddha Mataji and Radhika Raman Prabhuji from Boise Temple. And Radhika Raman Prabhuji is right now in East Coast in Virginia. She's an associate professor in the Hinduism. And there is nothing more. I'll give introductions about them. So please give one more hearty welcome to both of them. Please. So question, you wanted to continue or anybody can ask question in between or just give it the tomorrow most?
We're going to stop in between to ask for questions.
Okay.
So after each section of the seminar, we'll stop and ask for questions.
Okay, no problem. So just a logistics one. Can you guys see the presentation here, the projector? Or is it probably blocking? Can you see it? It's okay. And if anybody has kids, we have in the middle unit, we will play some Krishna puppet show. So if you can stay here, stay some time. But if you feel bored, definitely go and see in the middle unit. Okay. So also one more thing, as this is Saturday, many people may come to visit the Lord. So I would see at least give an aisle here and move one side, at least give some space so people can come. And in the front also please leave a little space for them. Oh, I see. Huh? For darshan, okay. I don't know, it may not be that well changing in the last minute, people do not know. So let it be, if something comes up, then we might need to adjust this way. But at least give something if somebody comes over a little way. I know we are a cozy room, but try our best. Okay, then Hare Krishna, thank you. I'll give it to.
So we have one more.
So who will use more? So one will be,
you have one stand or you have another
only
stand?
Only one stand.
That's okay.
No, we have this one in the, yeah, can you get that?
This is good.
No, we have headphones so that you don't need to hold it. So put it in a head.
Let me see this one.
Huh?
My mother will be, it will be easier for her to do this.
Yeah.
She's
let's see that one if you do. This will be good.
Hare Krishna. So it's a great pleasure to be here in San Jose. I guess for myself, it's my second visit. The first one was just a few weeks ago for Hanumat Preshaka Maharaj's Vyas Puja. And for my mother, it's first time here. Beautiful, beautiful deities. It's amazing. It's actually taken us so long to have their darshan because we're from Boise, Idaho, which is just one hop, skip, and jump away from here. One short flight, San Jose Airport, Alaska Airlines flies directly to Boise, Idaho. I'm coming from a little bit farther. I live in Virginia now, where I teach at the College of William and Mary. But Boise is still home, so in that sense, I'm close to home here. But thank you all very much for having us and for participating in this seminar. Usually we begin with some kirtan, but considering that you've already had a pretty substantial morning program just before this, and considering that we're also running a little late, what we'll do is maybe we can just chant the invocation prayers together that Prabhupada gives at the beginning of Bhagavad Gita, and then continue for the seminar. Okay. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Jena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Jena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dina Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhyayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaura Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. So this seminar is called The Art of Krishna Conscious Homeschooling and Parenting. The seminar is something that's developed over now the past, what, maybe 10 years? It's been a decade almost since my mother first started giving this seminar. The first one actually happened not too far from here in Seattle. And then from that point on, it grew and spread around the world. Basically, it started off in a very organic fashion. After my mother completed homeschooling myself and my younger brother, sometime after that, devotees started calling her or emailing her, asking for advice on parenting and specifically on homeschooling, Krishna conscious education, things like that. And as she started receiving questions on a regular basis, she realized that there was a pattern there and devotees were looking for similar things. And so she decided, well, why not put some of these into a cohesive class or talk or seminar? And after delivering it, realized that there's a great desire for this kind of knowledge and experience. And from that point on, started delivering these seminars in different cities here in the United States and then around the world. And so now this seminar has been given all over India, all over the United States, through most countries in Europe, Australia, parts of Africa, and so on. So it's really something that we hope you'll find useful in some way or another. The seminar itself is something that's been blessed and encouraged a lot by the ISKCON Ministry of Educational Development, and as one of the options available to try to give our children a Krishna conscious education. Now, the seminar itself is designed to talk to parents about, or future parents about, or those who advise parents about the about homeschooling in particular as a method for Krishna conscious education, teaching children at home. Now, this is what my mother did with the two of us. But we also realize the fact that for some parents, whatever the reason may be, homeschooling may not work out, or it may not be an option, or they may not be ready for it as yet. We hope you'll consider it seriously. But in case it can't be the an option, what you hear in this seminar over all of today and part of tomorrow, at least 75-80% of those principles of Krishna conscious education that we describe here would be applicable in any circumstance, whether the kids are going to school, or whether the kids are going to Gurukul, or whether they're studying at home, right? So that's why we say the art of Krishna conscious homeschooling and parenting, because the basic principles of giving our children Krishna conscious education actually are the same, regardless of whether we apply them in one context or another. Okay, so that's why we hope it'll be broadly helpful, even if you can't do the full homeschooling idea. Now, during the course of the talk, we'll stop at regular intervals, and once we cover a particular topic, then we'll ask for questions. And those questions, specifically, we're hoping for questions about what we just talked about. And then we'll move on to the next topic. There should be a good amount of time for questions today, doing that system. But then there are always additional questions, general questions that you think of after digesting it overnight, or topics that we don't have a chance to cover. And those will have an opportunity tomorrow. There's a dedicated question and answer session. And by that time, usually there's a whole range of different issues and questions that devotees want to talk about. So that's the overall format of the seminar here. So we'll just start with one really nice statement from Srila Prabhupada. He says, if we train children by developing and encouraging their propensity to love Krishna, then we shall be successful in educating them to the topmost standard. And this is kind of the guiding principle behind the seminar today, that as devotees of Krishna, there are values that we hold in great esteem, and those values are inculcated in our children with their desire to love Krishna. And that is the ultimate standard for education. My mother's going to be speaking about this very soon. But just to start off with, we'd like to give you darshan of our lifelong masters and deities in Boise, Shishi Radha Banki Bihari. They have been our providers and protectors and caretakers and for so many years now. My parents, they moved to Boise in 1986. I was 4 years old at that time. My younger brother was two. And when they first got to Boise, it was it was something that they were nervous about, spiritually speaking, because they had lived a year in Los Angeles, which, as you know, is quite a vibrant and large community of devotees. Even back then in the 80s, it was very active, and they had plenty of nice association. Before that, in Chicago at Kishori's temple. And then my father got this job in Boise. His job disappeared in Los Angeles. And the next job that he found was with Hewlett-Packard. They have a very large branch for laser jet printers. Their headquarters is, of course, here, but their laser jet printers, a lot of what they do is there in Boise. They employ about 3,000 or 4,000 people there. And so he got a job with them, and when they initially moved there, there were no devotees whatsoever. A very small place, maybe at that time less than 100,000 people. And it wasn't just a small town in a string of small towns. It's a small town in the middle of nowhere. There's nothing. If you drive 6 hours in any direction, you don't see anything. in Boise. It's now gotten a little bit bigger, but originally it was like that. And so Krishna sent them there for some reason or another, but when they got there, then they gradually started holding programs in their home, just as a little gathering of interested persons, devotees. And for about 10, 15 years, it took place in our living room, and gradually it grew and grew and grew, and Shri Radha Banki Bihari came, and other deities, and eventually it grew to the point where it wasn't going to fit, it wasn't working in the home. And so then we got the property next door, and with the help of all the devotees there, built a beautiful temple to Shri Radha Banki Bihari. Not a huge temple, but about mid-size. And that's been now, let's see, 14 years since that temple arose. And now there's a wonderful community of devotees living all around the temple, around the street. They've bought homes. And it's centered around the deities and also the homeschooling. It's a homeschooling community where everyone there has either already completed educating their children if they move there for a while at home, or they're doing it right now. And so it became a little place to practice the techniques of Krishna conscious homeschooling that we'll be talking about here. After we were grown up, then another generation of young kids came. And now these techniques and these methods are practiced in communities all over the world and all over the United States as well.
Hare Krishna. So, Radhika, I'm really happy to be here. It's my first visit to San Jose. I'm really looking forward to association with a lot of you. And so, like Radhika said, we moved to Boise and there was nothing there, no devotee association. So naturally when my children, they turned for, you know, school going age, like 5 years old, I started thinking about school for them. Where am I going to send them to school? And I started investigating public schools, private schools, and we opted for a private school. And so they went to school for about 2 years, and I was a devotee, a new devotee, and I was worried. I was worried about the things they would learn there. So I started to volunteer time to go into their classroom, see what's being taught. And there were some experiences that some things that I saw that made me very determined that I should think of an alternative. At that time, homeschooling was not known to me. I had no idea that it actually existed. So I even put them in a Seventh-day Adventist school, which I thought, well, they would be vegetarians and it would be a nicer place for them. But my youngest son, one time, he came back home and told me that how the teacher has spent the entire day talking about good behavior. Just no classes, nothing, just talking about behavior, because a few children were very, very misbehaved and she was so frustrated. And that made, you know, and I thought, oh my gosh, the whole day wasted, you know. And so then, you know, it made me realize that actually schools are pretty much secular places, secular institutions, where talk of God is not allowed. And naturally, there can be no good behavior without God consciousness. In fact, Radhika one time came and told me, he was so shocked. She says, my teacher, she spelled God with a small G, you know. So this, you know, so naturally, unless there's values, I mean, the values can only be there when there's God consciousness. And then another time, Gopal, he came home and he told me how his class teacher was a young woman whose boyfriend would come in class and they would openly kiss in front of the children. And then another time, and many times, he would come home very upset because they would make fun of him. He had a shikha and his food was a little strange, you know, for them, like chapatis. I would pack them chapati and sabji and they would make fun of him. But the class teacher would not reprimand the other kids not to do that. And that made him feel really bad that she would not say anything and they would just laugh at him. And then one time I sat for Radhika's math class and I noticed how he had finished his math homework in about 15 minutes. He was done. And he was sitting there bored. And it is said that the public all these schools are actually made for the average. If your child is above average, then he's pretty much not challenged. And if he's below average, he's frustrated. So again, academically, I felt like I could give a lot more, you know, that he could be more challenged. And one time he told me that, you know, that it was a usual thing where they would heat the lunches in the microwave for children. It was a private school, so they made this special facility. One time Radhika's lunchbox was swapped with another boy's lunchbox. And then when he was given the lunch, he found himself biting into some chicken stuff, which he thought was, you know. So luckily he didn't digest it, he threw it out. But, you know, so these things were going on. So that's when I started looking at different options. I talked to my husband, and I was trying to find an alternative. And that's when I found this idea of homeschooling. And of course, like most of you would think, you know, we were very, very nervous about it, because thinking, homeschooling, I mean, what is that, you know? What will happen? And my relatives and my, you know, they were all against it. But then we felt like, okay, we should try it out. So what I did in summer, I bought a curriculum. You know, as you know, homeschooling is a very accepted education here in the United States. Actually, there's 2.5 million people who are homeschooling today. I found out yesterday that there's 180,000 people in California who are homeschooling, 30,000 in the Bay Area. And a lot of them are also from India who are homeschooling. So this homeschooling is a well-accepted practice. So it was easy for me to get information about it online. And then I went to attend one of these support groups, and I found out all about it. And I said, okay, academically, I know they won't suffer, because there's so much facility here, so much curriculums you can buy and teach. You can even buy curriculums where they assign teachers, and you can send your work to them if you don't feel confident about it. So I said, okay, then we're going to start in summer and see how it goes. And by the end of summer, if you're not happy, then they can go back to school. So there's no loss. So we bought a curriculum, and then I started teaching them. And in 3 months' time, they had finished the entire year's curriculum. That's how, you know, effective it was, because there's so much quality time, so much, you know, one-to-one that I was spending with the children. So Prabhupada said that, you know, our children are not ordinary children. They're very special children, because they're born from devotee families. All of us, we are from India, and we know we had, you know, our parents taught us some nice Vedic values, and we had, you know, we were vegetarians and things like that. But none of us can say that we were chanting Krishna's name from the day we were born. Our children grow up, you know, taking Krishna's name, worshipping the deity. They're very, very special children. Prabhupada said that these children, as parents, we should give them such good training that this can be their last birth. And then in their life, they have come here so that they can go back to Godhead, and we should give them. But birth alone, obviously, is not going to be enough, because, you know, along with birth, they have to have good training. So this is something that that's why we decided. And of course, there's benefits, which I'm going to go very, you know, quickly through that. We just talked about academically how homeschooling, we can do so much. And of course, we all are aware of the negative association in schools, especially the peer pressure. Things are getting worse and worse everywhere around the world. We'll be talking about how important it is for children, especially in the early stages of their life, to get good association, to get good examples, especially the examples of older people, you know, of seniors, where they can actually, because they mimic, you know. We have to give them good role models. And Prabhupada talks about how today in schools, academically, they want to make sure that the teachers are very well qualified. But in terms of character, they're definitely not good role models. He said, actually, a teacher cannot be a teacher if he smokes or drinks, you know, if he's not following the four regulative principles. Because that kind of, you know, character that a teacher has, you know, is going to rub off on the children. And in Vedic times, the teachers were qualified in that way. They had Vedic values. They were without greed and envy. So when they would impart the knowledge to the children, it would be, you know, very effective. You know, they were such good examples. And that's, we lack that today. We don't have. And so he says that this is a misuse of higher intelligence. In other words, we are very qualified, you know, intelligently, but it's really a misuse of intelligence when, you know, we do that. And of course, you know, homeschool kids can get very good examples from us, from our, you know, other devotees, that, you know, we can provide them. And what to talk about association from Prabhupada's books, you know, so much good association, especially Shastra, Srimad Bhagavatam, because all these great personalities in the Srimad Bhagavatam, they're great devotees whose example, action, whose character rubs on them. Children like to imitate them. Children, especially people, you know, saints like Dhruva and Prahlad, they like to be like them. So Prabhupada's vision for our children was that they not only get academic education, but they also get trained, you know, in character. He emphasized that so much, and that's why he wanted Gurukulas, because he wanted this character education for them. Because, and we know higher education is not necessarily means good character. We know that how people, society has fallen down so much, and it's all from, you know, educated community as well. So it's not a formula for happiness. The formula for happiness is, you know, when we put Krishna in the center. So so Prabhupada was very much, and he also gave the example how people just 50 years ago, he said in India, people, all the rich people, the influential people in India would send their children to Gurukulas just because they understood the value of this kind of education, where they wanted their children to learn qualities like self-control, humility, tolerance, and things like that. So he wanted a Gurukula. His instruction was a Gurukula, but then where for every one of us, Gurukula is obviously not the option. There are very few. They may be very far away, and it may not be practical for us to send. Maybe we may not be ready to send our children to Gurukula, even though it, you know, there are some very good Gurukulas. So how do we follow this Prabhupada's instruction of a Gurukula? So in a homeschooling situation, we can do that because the kula, the ashram, becomes the home, and the parents can become the guru. So we can actually take all these instructions that Prabhupada gave us and actually apply it in the home. So our homeschooling was basically, was just a part of a bigger Krishna conscious lifestyle. In other words, our children just pretty much did what we were doing. And that's how Prabhupada wanted our children to be trained, is that they simply follow what the elders are doing. You know, they get up in the morning, we read Shastra, we do a morning program, we read Shastra, and then we apply what we learn, apply what we read in practical devotional life. In other words, after reading Srimad Bhagavatam, we apply those principles. And that's what we did. You know, we went on, you know, book distribution, Harinam. We did school programs. We did deity worship, festivals, so many nice things. And through that, they got the education. Of course, the Shastra gave them, you know, the knowledge where intelligently they could understand why we, it's important to be a devotee. And then we applied those teachings. And of course, in a homeschooling situation, it always helps for parents to be Krishna conscious. But frankly, I can tell you, when I started homeschooling, I did not feel qualified at all. I was a very new devotee. I hadn't read any Shastra, Prabhupada's books, and I felt very, very unqualified and nervous. But then I noticed, because I had to give an example to my children, so I was eager to do the right things. And so as I got up and did my morning program, I read Shastra and did all these practical devotional service, you know, did preaching programs, did festivals, my faith in Prabhupada's teachings became more stronger and stronger. And as my faith increased and I saw the children so happy, and, you know, then I my faith increased and I became more, I felt more and more qualified to become a teacher. So a lot of us feel like we can teach, but the fact of the matter is that we parents are natural teachers. You know, we don't have to go to college to understand what the strengths of our children, the weaknesses of our children. It's natural for us to know the children better than anybody else. So this way, if we just try if we just try and follow what Prabhupada told us, the formula for happiness, the formula for becoming a good devotee, just following the simple program of, you know, what he gave us, we all feel qualified. And naturally, when in the early stages, all of us can teach our children, right? We can give them elementary math and English. And as they get older, because homeschooling is such a gives such skills on of independent study. I mean, we don't spoon feed them. We don't. We teach them how to be independent. When they get older, they are able to study on their own with some guidance from us.
The seminar has three parts to it. The first one, as you see up here, is called Purity is the Force. They come from this motto that we hear often in ISKCON, Purity is the Force, books are the basis, and preaching is the essence. And the idea behind the three parts is the first part, Purity is the Force, talks about creating the right environment at home to allow to make it conducive to raising Krishna conscious children. Okay, so it's dealing with lifestyle changes and home environment. The second part, Books Are the Basis, deals with the actual education, the academic side of things, the curriculum, but especially focusing on studying Srila Prabhupada's books and Srimad Bhagavatam with our children. And the third, Preaching is the Essence, talks about social skills, discipline, outreach, preaching activities, festivals, and other topics that would be considered basically extracurricular activities in a school setting, but in a homeschool setting would be very much an essential part of the curriculum as a whole. Okay, so these are the three parts of the seminar, and after each part, then we're going to stop and ask for questions and see if you have any further ideas on that particular part. Okay. So the first one, preparing the home environment. The first element in purifying the home is to remove unwanted things that work against our attempt to raise Krishna-conscious kids. In other words, if we're trying, Prabhupada gives the example that if you're trying to light a fire by rubbing two sticks of wood together, and then at the same time you're pouring water on top of those sticks of wood, then is your fire going to come up? No, it's not going to happen. In other words, that as we do what's right, we also have to stop doing what is working against that. Right? And one of the first things that is necessary in that regard is by turning off the television. Maybe some of you have already done this. Maybe others have been thinking about it for a long time, but yet haven't had the strength or the courage to do it. But the TV is one thing that practically, just that one thing, if it can be removed from our life completely, it does wonders for helping the education as well as the spiritual life of our children. You see, the problem with television is twofold. One is in terms of the content of what you see on TV, and the other is in terms of the method of learning from the television. First of all, in terms of the content, the television, you know, we work so hard to try to follow the four regulative principles in a world that basically works against that, glorifying these. No meat eating, no illicit sex, no gambling, no intoxication. The television is basically founded on these four sinful activities, right? It's the basic foundation of TV. Everywhere you look, one of these four things is always being glorified, whether it's meat eating or it's illicit relations between men and women or intoxication of some kind. It's always going on in the TV. And so those messages become so persistent. They've done many studies that when you see the same thing about six or seven times, then practically it's inevitable that you come to learn it. You come to believe it, actually. And this is the idea behind television, is over and over and over and over again, those messages are given to us, so it becomes, it looks, feels natural. This is what the world does, this is what we do therefore also. Studies have shown again and again that children are so much more likely to believe something that they see on a screen as true. If they see it on a screen, they think it's true. Even as adults, if you see it on TV, you think it must be true. You know, even products in the store, they have a little label on, they say, as seen on TV. Right? Why would seeing this on TV make it a better product? There's no logical reason for that. But they say as seen on TV, because if you see it on TV, then people tend to think, oh, it must be good. Right? It must be true because it's been seen on TV. And you know, why would someone spend $10,000 for 30 seconds if it wasn't good? So it breaks down these barriers we have to question things, to be suspicious, and tries to convince us that, yes, this is what's actually desirable in life. Right? This is the basic point, is the television is saying, this is what you need. It's giving us, telling us needs that we never knew we had. Right? You cannot survive without this. Well, we survived without this for last 10, 15, 20, 30 years. But now that I've seen it, I cannot survive without it. It creates needs that never existed before. So in terms of character development, it's really harmful in that way. Mother Urmila, who's one of ISKCON's most famous educators, she wrote an article years ago in Back to Godhead magazine where she called the television the one-eyed guru. The one-eyed guru. And you see, it's very much like that, right? People, they come home from work, and just like we sit in front of the spiritual master humbly, so everyone gathers in front of the TV on the sofa, and everyone's... And just like you listen quietly in front of the guru and you don't say, so when the television's going on, then the kids don't make any noise, the parents don't make any noise, shh, don't say anything, we're listening to our favorite program. And we sit there and we listen just like it's the spiritual master, just like the guru. But the difference is, the gurus, we get to hear his words how often? Well, maybe, you know, once a year you may actually see the spiritual master, or you may listen once a week. You come to the temple to listen to Bhagavatam class, or come on Sundays to listen to Sunday feast class. This guru, we listen to every single day for so many hours. And not only that, he has direct access to our own homes. Whereas we have to go see the spiritual, get spiritual knowledge somewhere else, this guru comes to our own home, gives us knowledge in the most intimate conditions of our life, when our guard is completely down. When we're not suspicious, we're relaxed, we're tired, then we come and we receive knowledge from this guru. Its effect can be stunningly effective, actually, the television. The study said that the average American household has the television running for 6 hours and 47 minutes every day. By the time an American is 65 years old, they will have spent 9 years of their life staring at a television. Can you think? 9 years. How much can you accomplish? If someone said, you know, you sometimes wonder, you think, give me, what if I just had a couple more hours in the day, my life would be okay, right? Just 2 hours short. Imagine if someone offered you a gift of 9 years. What would happen? We think, oh, no, we're Indians, we don't watch so much. It's not a fact. We don't realize that 30 minutes here, 30 minutes there, 20 minutes here of my favorite program, 10 minutes of commercials there, how quickly it adds up, and then a couple extra hours on Saturday or Sunday. How quickly it adds up in terms of the total average. So one is in terms of content. The other problem with television is in terms of the method itself. The first part is in terms of content. The second is in terms of the method by which it teaches us. So method means what? Sometimes people say, well, what about educational programs on TV? We only watch the Discovery Channel, or we only watch, you know, Safe Children's Channel or something like that. But two things. Number one, even the content of so-called safe channels is still glorifying the same things, but in a childish manner. You look at even cartoons and the way the boys and the girls behave in those cartoons, and the type of suggestive behavior that is present there. It's amazing, right? But suppose you find a nice thing about monkeys and lions and, you know, in Africa, an educational program. Okay, so maybe the content's not so bad. But the method of learning is actually very damaging to the mind. You see, what the television does, imagine this. If you're reading a book and you're looking at the words on the page and it's telling a nice story or description, what does the mind have to do? You have to work to read, to extract the information off the page, and then the mind has to create a picture in the head. Right? An image in the mind. The mind has to be imaginative to visualize what it is you're reading. If you listen to the radio or something recorded, then you don't have to take the effort to extract the information, but you still have to create the picture in your head. Right? The mind is active. In the television, the problem is that whatever you're learning, you don't have to make any effort to get that information. It's given to you. You see it, you hear it, and the visualization is also given to you right there. And they've done studies hooking up electrodes to people's brains while they're watching television, and the level of activity is practically nothing. Right? It's you become a vegetable. It's not an active learning process. And therefore, that knowledge is not retained, and your abilities to think critically and accept that information also go away very fast, right? So it basically destroys, and again, studies have shown consistently that children who watch regular television score much lower in standardized exams in mathematics and the sciences and English comprehension and all of those things, because the brain basically becomes lazy as a result. So even if you want to learn about lions in Kenya, the better thing to do is find a book about lions and tigers for the kids to read rather than sitting them in front of a Discovery Channel program. On top of that, of course, you also have the commercials, which are present on every channel. And those commercials, they are specifically targeted to the children, right? Because if it's a program for children, it'll be targeted towards children to get them attached very early on to all those things and make them a good customer for life when they grow up. So this is the difficulty in terms of television, both in terms of the content but also in terms of the method of learning. It's one of those things which is just very, very damaging overall to the process of education. Sometimes people worry that, if my kids don't watch any TV or any news even, then how will they won't look smart, right? They won't be impressive in society. But the fact of the matter is it doesn't take a lot to keep up with what's going on in the world. It doesn't take a lot to look smart in the world. Means if you just read the headlines on the front page of the newspaper, right? Even not the front page, just the top half of the newsletter, of the newspaper, so you don't even have to buy it. You can just look at it. You get 90% of all the news that's immediately important for going on. You watch television, the news channels, they tell the same story again and again and again and again. And they say, we have some breaking news. There's one car, the police chasing one car. Looks like they're going fast. Oh, they just made a left turn. And by the time the story plays out, then we'll be back to you right after these commercials. 15 minutes later, they're still chasing the car, right? And there's a new development. He just crashed. If you come to that same story the next morning, you'll get the full thing, right? Police chase car crashes, two men died, right? Whatever it is. You'll get the full story right there. And that's all you need to know, yes? It's very, there's not a whole lot of effort that's needed. Okay, so there'll be some conversations and social situations where our children may not know what's on the latest episode in Nickelodeon channel or whatever they watch, right? They may not know what the latest thing is or who did this, but then that's okay. That's okay. Means, isn't it true that as human beings, we all fit in some social situations and don't fit in other social situations. Means if you go out on the street and you talk to your average person, how much will you fit with them in terms of their social life? Will you know who their latest rappers are, for example, or who the hip-hop stars are? Maybe. 90% of us may not know. Does it matter? No, it doesn't matter so much. Right? There are some conversations we know, some we don't know. As parents, as devotees, we've made a certain choice, right? A certain lifestyle choice, that we want our children to look intelligent in front of Krishna. Right? We want Krishna to be impressed by our children. We want the spiritual master to be happy with the children. We want the devotee community to be happy. Other social circles, okay, they may be left out a couple conversations, but people learn. Friends, they realize, oh no, okay, these, you know, Ravi's not going to be really good at telling what the latest episode is, but they'll talk about other things. You know, they'll talk about other things. So we should not be afraid. We should not be afraid to put off this, to cut off this kind of thing. Now, one might say, well, you know, TV, we hardly ever watch TV anymore. TV is actually, in some sense, it's outdated. It's old technology, right? And now, far more important than television is... is the internet, right? Ultimately, the video games are also all online now. The good ones are all multiplayer, different parts of the world online. The internet is really the most important, the new thing. And the internet is such that it has all the qualities of the television plus more. Right? Plus more. Whereas the television, the channels are still limited. Even if you have full cable subscription, you get what? How many channels? Only like, what, 300 or something like that? 250 channels? Still limited, yes? But internet is ananta, right? It's unlimited. Anadi and ananta is constantly ever-increasing. And 90% of it is an ever-increasing landfill. It's a collection of trash, of junk. Most of, I think we all know this, there's no reason to need to argue this, that most of what's on the internet is no beneficial. Now, the thing is the television as a tool may be very useful. In fact, for most professions in today's world, it's essential. It means there's no way you can do a job unless you did something that was totally menial work. Just about any job in today's world requires the internet. So internet is a very useful tool. It's a very useful tool. But it ought to be used like a tool. Tool means what? When you need it, you take it, you use it, and then you put it away. Yes, it's like a hammer. When you need a hammer, a very useful tool, yes, you can use it. But then it's not that you carry the hammer around with you all the time, right? That just in case I might need the hammer, let's keep myself always hammered for this purpose. So with internet, it can be useful as a tool. But the problem is when we start using it as a substitute for two things. As a substitute for knowledge, and as a substitute for human relationships. These two things cause a serious difficulty, a serious problem. First, in terms of knowledge. According to the Vedas, one basic principle about knowledge, one basic principle of the conveyance of knowledge is that the source of knowledge is more important than the content. Because if the source is reliable, trustworthy, then you know that the content will be good or at least given with the best interest in mind. Just like a mother or a father. They may not know everything in this world, but their advice to the children is very valuable because they have the best interests of the children in mind. Whereas someone who knows so much in this world, they may be a genius, but they tell you something, you don't know. Should I trust it? Should I not trust it? Are they trying to manipulate me? Are they trying to flatter me, to use me in some way? Yeah. The source has to be reliable, then the content, okay, then we can go to the content. The internet, on the other hand, is founded on the exact opposite principle. The internet is all about content without source. 99% of all the websites, do they list who the author is? Who's saying what? Where it's coming from? No. Right. They don't say. The source, the internet is such that, you see, in the past, if someone had something they wanted to say, they would have to study for years. They would have to do the work of writing it, then finding a publisher. And then at the end of their life, they'd write some book, my experiences in life, what I learned, and they would distribute it to their friends, give it to their kids to read, and maybe it would become famous. These days, any fool who has anything to say can find an audience of thousands on the internet. Yes, thousands. And just because there are 10,000 people who click on the site every day doesn't signify anything in terms of its worth. Right? It could just signify actually that it's quite useless, and this is why it's so interesting. So it's all about content without source, and that's a recipe for misinformation, according to the opposite of knowledge, according to the Vedas. And so, in terms of as a source of knowledge, I mean, when I teach in the university courses, and for my students, the biggest struggle I have is try to convince them and teach them how to do research outside Google. And this is not just myself. All of us, all the professors there, we're constantly working to teach our students how to discriminate between sources of knowledge. At least in the past, you got a book, you mean someone must have vetted it before it could get published, right? But these days, to teach students, okay, what is that source? It's so difficult, so difficult. If I assign them a paper to write on yoga, they'll type in yoga in Google, and they'll see the top 10 hits, and they'll click on each one, and they'll do cut, copy, and paste, right? And you know where they're getting it from, because everyone's papers have the same paragraph in it, right? Because it was in the first page of the Google hits. Yeah? So this is an important skill, not just for the spiritual life, but also for material life. Right? Also for material life. That's in terms of knowledge. The other thing was in terms of human relationship. And this is a lot more difficult to see, and in some sense more dangerous also. People who feel isolated sometimes think that the internet can serve as a substitute for that. It cannot. It cannot. Despite all the social networking sites that we have, the fact of the matter is that the current generation of students that we are training in this country and around the world is the most socially disconnected and incompetent generation of students. I see this with my students all the time. They don't often have even the simple ability of maintaining or starting a conversation with a stranger, with someone they don't know. Two people will get together and they'll say, oh, hi, how are you? And then there's an awkward silence and each one pulls out their phone and they start looking at something and the other guy thinks, oh, okay, I better do that too. And they pull out their phone. And they're texting someone, they're talking to someone, making an arrangement for a future meeting. How often do you see two people walking down the road together or sitting together doing something? And clearly they had decided to spend time together. And yet one person's phone rings and, oh, hold on just a second, please. And they're talking and say, yeah, I'll be there this evening. I'll say, arranging their next meeting. In the meantime, the other person is feeling left out. So he thinks, no one called me. I better call someone. So he picks up and calls someone. And pretty soon, they're there, supposed to be taking association from each other. And instead, they're in two completely parallel worlds. Right? Basically, what develops is an attachment, a hiding behind of the screen. And now more and more psychologists are realizing the facet of internet addiction. Right? It's actually now a recognized disorder. I knew one friend who, or acquaintance, Facebook deleted his account. He used to spend all his time on Facebook, and Facebook deleted his account for using it too much, right? Overuse. And I think part of it was they were worried he was, I don't know, spamming or doing some business, but he was genuine. He just had a lot of friends, right? And his whole life fell apart, practically. Right? His whole life fell apart. I mean, how many times do you hear in the news also of children doing physical harm to themselves or others because someone said something on Facebook? Right? So the point is, we lose social skills. We lose face-to-face ability to interact with individuals, with others, and we think that the screen can serve as some cheap substitute for that when it cannot. Right? It cannot. The basic principle from all of this is that in raising our children as devotees, we have to be very careful about the screen. The screen in any way, shape, or form is one of Maya's most effective tools in Kali Yuga. One of Maya's, I know this is Silicon Valley, and I know it's this whole valley is sort of founded on the screen. But the point is, it is one of Maya's most effective tools. This is, in some sense, this place is more effective at spreading Maya's activities than is Las Vegas. Right? Las Vegas, you have to come to do something legalized, or illegal, but the point is, it's what they say, what happens in Las Vegas stays in Las Vegas, right? But what happens in Silicon Valley, what happens behind the screen, goes everywhere, right? Maya has the ability, it's the definition of Maya is that which is not, right? Always changing. Never you can grasp Maya. And that's the nature of the screen, right? Always changing. The average scene in this television lasts for, what, 10 seconds, one shot. Right? The average website goes in and out just like that. Information you thought was reliable, tomorrow can be changed with no apologies, right? Only disclaimers there at the bottom. Right? It's ephemeral. It's always changing. That's the very definition of Maya. And it's the opposite of Satya or Sat, which is eternal, it's stable, it's always present. So if we're going to use the internet, yes, we have to, I know. It's important and those skills are required and so on. We use it as a tool, not as a substitute for social relationships, not as a source of knowledge. We turn it on and we turn it off, not always connected, right? Not always online, not always keeping updated and so on. We use it as it's a very useful substitute for the post office. You use it for email. It's a useful substitute for having to go to a bank physically. You use it to check your accounts, to make a deposit or whatever. But as a tool, just like you would never dream of spending your day and nights at a bank, there's no reason to spend your day and night on the internet. Right? Just like any tool, use it and then off. There should be the majority of time during the day when you're disconnected, not linked in all the time. Okay, so that's the basic principle behind this. It's so important. Even if we're practicing this halfway, it's. I would encourage you to see ways in which you can reduce this further and further, and you'll see how much time is freed up in your life and your kids' life to do so many nice things. It's so many nice things.
So some of the things that we can do to keep a very nice home environment, which is conducive for our children's spiritual growth, and one of them is morning program. We are all creatures of habit. So naturally, if we do something every day after day and day, then it'll become a habit, second nature to us. And that will, help us all of our life. You know, a good morning program purifies the mind, and when a child begins the day with that, then he becomes very peaceful. I used to notice that when we were doing this every day, then the discipline became less of an issue. You know, because naturally the minds, after a full morning program and reading Srimad Bhagavatam, they would become quite, you know, and if they were naughty, it was in a transcendental way, you know. Of course, sometimes children are really naughty and then you have to discipline them, but this really helps towards curbing their restless nature. And of course, children, when they are very little, we cannot have a full morning program, which takes an hour, but so we can reduce the amount of time. We can be flexible. For example, with smaller children, we can just have it 10 minutes or 15 minutes, but we have to make sure that we're enthusiastic. Like I was staying at, you know, Prabhu's house, and I noticed how he was singing so loudly and so nicely with the children. Now, that's really important. We have to be always enthusiastic. You know, Bali Mardhan Prabhu was singing so, you know, so enthusiastically with the children. So that helps, because then the children seeing the parents so enthusiastic and dancing and chanting loudly is very effective for the children. And of course, they want to take part in it. They want to become pujaris. So one day they can be the pujari. If you have two children, one, they can take turns. One becomes a pujari, the other one sings, leads the kirtan like this.
We can go. I can just add one little experience also myself. Now I have a 2.5-year-old, almost 3, and another child who's 6 months. And with our 2-year-old, he's, you know, terrible twos, is a time of tantrums, and I want this and this and that. And I've noticed that in the mornings, this will start as soon as he wakes up complaining, I want this, until we do the morning program. And we sit down and we do the morning program together. And even at the age of 2.5, children can be fully involved in the morning program, right? It's they see their parents, they follow the example. He'll sing all the Samsara Dava prayers, he'll lead Nisinga Arati and so on. And after that, he's different, right? He's changed. The mood is so much more calm. And then, of course, during the day, it deteriorates again. Then again, you do some spiritual activity. But it does make a very big difference in the mood of the children and their environment. And right from the start, if they get that daily routine, the thing is that if we are rising early and doing our japa and chanting and mangalarti and so on, then when the kids wake up, we should do, like my mother said, even if it's a short morning program, we do it again with them. The whole thing. Even it just, you from Samsara Dava, you do Nrisimha prayers, Tulsi Arati, you give water to Tulsi. The whole thing you can do in 15 minutes, if that's only the time you have. Right? But we do that again with our children, because it's so important for them to get the full morning program.
Yes. Sometimes children are so naughty that you want to dispense with it and say, I don't want to worry about it. We'll do it later. But no, it's important to do it. And sometimes it's more practical. You do it with the children, your own morning program with the children. But at no time should we give up and thinking it's not so important. You know, of course, a lot of you are going to, your children are going to school. So morning is a very rush time, right? So you can do a very brief one with them. They can do it, you know, you can have an altar where they can sing the samsara prayers before they go to school. And then when they come back in the evening, you can do a longer one, like the evening arthik and chanting together. So sitting together as a family in the evening also is so important, because chanting keeps the family together. You know, in the karmi world, they say, you know, they think of ways how to bring the family together. Like they'll sit in front of the TV, watch TV, or go for bowling or some kind of activity. And here, as devotees, we can do that twice a day, every day. And you can see the amount of, you know, how the togetherness that comes in doing that. When, as a family, we sit together, you know, and chant together and read Srimad Bhagavatam or some scriptures together, it's really, you know, the bonds are really, get really strong. So japa is also part of that morning program, and it's important to give them, you know, some a taste for japa. When my children were 3 and 5 years old, I first introduced them to beads. And of course, at 3 years old, they are not able to take it seriously. But it was okay to just even to see them chant half a round. But what I made sure is that I chanted with them so that they don't take it lightly or don't develop bad habits. you know, where, and these habits are important because then they go for all their life, you know, if they develop bad habits. So Prabhupada was, you know, he did not want us to force them, our children, to chant japa. At one time he was really upset in a gurukul where they were forcing the children and forcing them to chant japa, and he was really upset. He said, you don't need to force them. But at another time, he was upset because the children were not given beads to chant. And he said, unless you give them beads, how are they going to learn? So in other words, we have to find a balance where we have to encourage them to chant, but at the same time, we don't want to make it a negative experience. You know, one time, a neighbor devotee in Boise, she was getting her child to chant 16 rounds, just really like over-enthusiastic, you know. And he was very young, that boy. And so he was being forced, and eventually he got so against it that he didn't chant for months and months altogether. So we don't want that. Eventually, the children will take it up very fast. You know, once they see the other devotees do it, they see initiations, and they want to also develop a desire to get initiated, it will happen. Of course, we started out with, you know, my husband encouraged them to chant one for each birthday, one extra round for each birthday, like that, you know. So when they were eight, they chanted eight rounds, but eventually it became too much, right? So they had to give it up and then pick it up again. And by the time they were 17, they were, you know, chanting 16 rounds. So this, you know, this is something that we want to give our children, is this taste of the holy name, because it's the Yuga Dharma for this age, and it's very important.
Seeing the parents' enthusiasm for chanting is really helps, and especially the parents chanting with the children, even if it's just one round. But if you sit down and chant with the children, then it sends a very important message to them. Namely, that see, chanting is such a nice thing that even mummy and daddy look forward to chanting, right? Even they're so busy, they're adults, they can do anything they like. Right? That's one of the things that kids see about their parents, or the enviable position of doing exactly what you want. Whereas I have to do what they want. But even they are sitting down and they're chanting with me. And that really helps. I know my mother, I remember she would sit down with us, she would chant. And, you know, as little kids, the mind would start to wander. We'd this way, that way, we're looking at this, we're on. And she would constantly be encouraging us. So think about Krishna, think about the holy name. Prabhupada said, Krishna is dancing on your tongue. Can you feel him dance on your tongue when you're chanting? Right? And as kids, we took it seriously. You try to figure out how is Krishna dancing? Can I feel him? And it was very nice. It was very encouraging like that. So chanting with the kids and them seeing the example is encouraging. On the opposite end of the spectrum, we should never make japa a punishment. Right? That sometimes, oh, you were very, very bad, now go do one round to say sorry to Krishna. Right? Chanting is not a form of apology. Right? It's not a form of... Chanting is a wonderful, positive way to develop our relationship with Krishna. It's a way of spending time with Krishna. Not a way of saying sorry, of making confession. That's not the primary meaning of why we do the holy name. And we should not make it for children that it's a punishment for them. Or sometimes not a punishment, it just becomes, we present it as an obstacle. The kids say, Mom, I want ice cream. So you chant one round, then you're going to get ice cream. So what the message does that send? Is that what is really desirable in life is the ice cream, but chanting is simply a stepping stone or an obstacle for me to get what I really want. In this way, one day when I grow up, then I can get the ice cream directly without having to mess with this chanting business. So that's why chanting has to be in itself an activity, not a tool for something else or not a punishment for any other type of activity. Then japa becomes effective, and gradually they develop a taste for doing that.
So this seems like a topic that we are very much aware of, eating only prasadam, but it has a great significance for our children. As we know, you know, most of Krishna, that Krishna and a lot of his incarnations, he came to kill demons, but Lord Caitanya, he came actually to kill the demoniac mentality by two things, chanting of the holy name and eating prasadam. So, and we know, like, you know, if you go to a zoo, then the way they tame animals is by giving them food. So this way, we know that all of us, our consciousness can be tamed by eating prasadam, and especially about children, because they are so restless. They are so restless. So if we feed them prasadam, then they become more peaceful. Now, if the children are young and very little, then they need a lot of variety. We know how they are always demanding this and that. So we need to work a little extra where we give them so much variety of prasadam to satisfy them. And that keeps them away from non-offered food, from karmi food. But when they get older, you know, other interests take over and they don't need so much variety. And then they are happy with simple prasadam and we don't have to, you know, give them so much variety. So when my children were little, you know, we were always having to face the struggle, you know, of whether we should go to different, you know, places where we were invited, like parties, and what do we do. So one of the things that I tried to do was that, first of all, I fed them really well before we went there. Mm-hmm. You know, so I knew they wouldn't be asking too much. And then we would sit down and have a talk, you know, like, okay, we're going there, but, you know, this is, you know, there won't be prasadam, and why we, as devotees, we should have prasadam. So children need gentle reminders. It's not like, okay, I told them once, they should know that. No, they need reminders all the time, and I would do that, always sit down with them, explain to them. And of course, reading Shastra every day of your life, you're doing morning program, it all has its effect. They understand why we don't do that. Prabhupada, he says such wonderful things about you. He said children, they can eat as much as they want at any time. There should be no restriction in terms of eating. We should not try to punish them by not giving them food. It's not good for them. In other words, he said the only austerity children have is that they must get up in the morning and do a morning program. Other than that, they should play as much as they want. They should eat as much as they want. So Prabhupada gave very nice instructions of everything.
One of the things that Prabhupada said is that in Shastra say actually is that the reason food eating is so crucial is because the consciousness by which the food is prepared goes directly into the person who's consuming it. This is true of any kind of creative activity. Just like if you go to a museum and you look at a painting, yes, and the painting, say it's a painting of, I don't know, Picasso. All his paintings are really like a little bit off and the angle is wrong and so on. And you look at the paintings sometimes and you feel the pain that the creator, the painter was in, right? Or if you look at a beautiful Renaissance style painting with, you know, impressionistic and so on, the natural scenery, you look at the painting and your mind is full with those same nice thoughts and ideas and calm sense of things. So whatever consciousness the painter was in, they put that consciousness into the painting, and when you consume the painting, you see it, that same consciousness comes to you. In the same way, for any kind of creation, including food, whatever consciousness we're in, that consciousness goes into the food, and then whoever's eating it then gets that same consciousness within themselves. The only difference is paintings we may see once in a while. Food is something that is so much part of our life nonstop. Think about how many hours a day we spend dealing with food, whether it's eating food or it's preparing food or it's cleaning up after food or it's doing shopping to get food. I mean, how many hours we spend, how much time, how much desires we invest in eating good food. I'm looking forward to chaat tonight or to pizza tonight or this or that, right? So if just that aspect, Prabhupada says, we can make 100% Krishna conscious, then at least our life is already 50% Krishna conscious, because so much of time we're investing in it. So the example of the parents in this regard is really powerful for the students, for the children. One of the things I remember most in my childhood was my father's example in this regard of eating only prasadam. all of us, he was a working person. And, you know, he, for his job at HP, he was a product manager there. He had to go travel a lot to different places and introduce products and so on. And sometimes the trips would go several weeks and they would go to foreign countries. And there'd be no access to prasadam. Like in East Asia, he would go sometimes to China or Singapore or something. And devotees were there or they weren't there, far between. He wouldn't be able to go. And my mother would, of course, pack as much prasadam as she could for him to take. But how long can packed prasadam last? It doesn't last all that time. So he would look for devotees, he would find devotee restaurants, go to temples. But one time I remember he didn't find anything, practically speaking. And for a whole 3 days he lived just on dates and lettuce. Right? That's all he could find to eat. And I remember I was, I don't know, 10, 11 years old. I was so impressed by that. Like I thought, wow, he's really determined to do this. And when I grew older and went to university myself, then I thought, okay, if my father could do it and earn for all of us and keep down a good job and everything, then I can do it too. Why can't I? That example gave me the determination to then continue it through my education years and now when I'm working as well. It's not as difficult as it may at first seem, you know, doing this ourselves. I know we often have jobs where there's business lunches or we have to take people out or attend something. And that's there in any profession. Also, in the academic world, most of our meetings and so on happen over some kind of a meal. And we interview candidates, we take them out to lunch and to dinner. And you have to. So, you know, the system basically that I try to follow is you call the restaurant in advance, or if you have a secretary, you have the secretary do that, and you ask them, you know, I'm a very strict vegetarian, so can you please just prepare for me a plate of fresh cut fruit as the main course? I'll take a green salad to start with. You just take a plain green salad and as the starter, and a plate of fresh cut fruit as the main course, please. And then for dessert, I'll have strawberries. And usually the restaurants, you know, you take people out, it's decent, nice restaurants. That's all you're going to have? Yeah, that's all I'm going to have. And they feel so bad about it, they really put in a lot of effort into making that nice. And every time it happens, when I get my big salad or I bring my big fruit plate, everyone on the table, everyone stops the conversation and goes, wow, that looks really good. Someone really likes you back there in the kitchen, huh? I said, no, it's just fruit. That's all it is. But or else someone will say, I really should start eating healthy too. You know, that's a really good point. I've been trying to lose weight for years now. That's really good. They'll be impressed by it. Or if someone's a little bit more advanced, they'll say, so you have some beliefs you follow? Are you vegetarian? Say, yeah, I'm vegetarian. Says, okay, but they have something vegetarian on the menu. Says, well, actually, it's a little different. And the way I explain to my colleagues at work, I just tell them right in advance from the start that basically I'm a Vaishnava, and what that means is that I don't eat food that has been cooked in a kitchen which also cooks meat. I don't eat food that's been cooked in a kitchen which also cooks meat. And they immediately understand. They immediately understand because we may not be aware of it, but this is very common in other religious traditions. You look at kosher laws that Jewish people follow, right? The same thing. It's not just the ingredients, but the kitchen has to be pure and different, right? Milk in one kitchen, meat in a different kitchen, like that. Halal rules and regulations also, not just that this is something you cannot eat this, you can eat that, but how is it prepared, in what kitchen, in what way, right? So all the different religious traditions, many of them, they follow the same thing, and people they'll immediately say, oh, it's like kosher. You say, yeah, it's like kosher. When I was studying in Oxford, I told this to my advisor there, you know, because we'd have lunches at dinners where you would have to attend at the college, and it was like a formal event. And I explained my rules to him, and till the day I graduated, he thought I was practicing halal, you know, and then when I graduated, he came to me and said, so, did we satisfy your halal needs well here in the college? I said, yes, very, very nicely. Thank you very much. I had explained to him many times that it was a little different. It's Vaishnav, you know. But anyway, this is what he felt. It was fine, okay, no problem. He's, you know, he was very happy, very proud that he could provide that for us. So it's not that difficult if we make it a point to be determined. But we have to be consistent about it. That's the key. If you eat with one colleague, and then you don't eat with another. You go someplace and you feel the pressure and you go, okay, tiki, I'll order from the vegetarian menu. Then next time you go out, someone will definitely say, you ate last time, why didn't you eat this time? You don't like me, you like that person. Right? And that's when people feel hurt. Right? That's when people hurt. We just have to be consistent in whatever we do. Shri Radha Madan Mohan Ki Jai, Lakshmi Shingadev. If we do it consistently, no one will give us problems. We are very fortunate to live in a country where people respect those who stand up for their own beliefs. If we were living in other countries of the world, it would be very different, right? A whole different set of strategies. But we live in America where the culture is individualistic. As long as you stick to your beliefs, people respect you for it. If you're wishy-washy, then they can sense, okay, this person is, you know, if I push him enough, he'll collapse, and he'll do what you want. And that's what the children see. Actually, sometimes we worry about the children. Oh, they'll feel misfit. What will their friends say? They'll become weak. But actually, the kids are more courageous than often the parents are. They see our nervousness, they become frightened. But you see little kids, they're very courageous. You know, little 4 or 5-year-olds, they'll go up to their friends and they'll just say, I remember when I was a little kid, we went to a party once, and you know, my mother had explained everything. This is actually not us. This is another family in Boise. They had a small child, and their mother had explained that you're going to a birthday party, but you can't eat the cake. It has eggs in it. And eggs, what are eggs? And so eggs are little baby chickens. They're in, you know. And so this, she didn't know, but the little kid, she went to the party and her friends were saying, you want some cake? You want some cake? And she went to her friends and said, no, the cake has baby chickens in it. You're eating baby chickens. You know that? And her friend was like, oh my God, I'm eating baby chickens. And she ran to her mother and said, Mom, did you put baby chickens in the cake? And then it was the problem was on that side. Now how to explain? No, it's not baby chickens. The eggs are yet unfertilized still. What does that mean, Mom? Well, anyway, it's okay. You can eat it. You go on, eat it. Don't ask me to make it. Right? But the children are very bold. They're very bold because they know as long as the parents are there to support them, they won't be ashamed of what they're practicing.
Another thing that we should be aware of is good association for our children. And Prabhupada wrote some nice things about that. He said how children are like soft dough. However you mold them, they become. You know, you can turn them into kachoris or whatever, you know, because they're so pliable, you know, they're so impressionable. He said that children don't have any independent psychology. You know, in other words, he said, and he gave the example how nobody grows up, you know, enjoying drinking and smoking. It's generally developed by association. So if you keep our children in good association, they become very saintly. But if you keep them in bad association, they can actually become very, later on, they can become demoniac. So, and he also gave that example of that movie Tarzan, you know, how he grew up with monkeys. And so he, you know, got all the habits of monkeys. So children, they should be, and the way he said, we can raise children is by letting them just imitate the elders, whatever the elders are doing. If they simply do that, then they will be, you know, developing good habits. Of course, our own association. Of course, our own association is very, very important, and it has the greatest effect, you know, on the children. As parents, we have the greatest impact on our children in terms of training them, giving them spiritual education, giving them intelligence, so that later on, as they grow up, they will be able to, you know, ward off, you know, attraction towards, you know, illicit sex and drugs and things like that. And we are very much, you know, effective in that. And of course, like I said, sometimes you feel like, oh, I'm not there. You know, as devotees, I'm not, you know, I'm not strong enough. I still have my weaknesses. And like I said earlier, you know, as we do this process, I mean, the process that Prabhupada gave us is so powerful that as we do them, we actually become, give them, we'll be able to provide them that good association. And of course, there's other association that we can also depend on in our society, and that's the association of senior devotees, sannyasis, gurus, whose impact on the children is very, very strong. Even for a little while, the impact they have on the children is very strong. Because all children, they need role models. We know how in today's society, all the children, they have models. They have, celebrities who they want to follow. And obviously, if the celebrity is a questionable one, that we know many are, then the results can be very dangerous because they idolize those people. They are their role models. So if they do something wrong, they think it's okay. So we have to give our children good role models from early on so that they want to be the people that they look up to. They want to be like them. And during my children's growing up homeschooling years, we had three sannyasis. Like he said, Boise is a very out of the way place. So there were just like three sannyasis who were coming and giving and visiting Boise, and spending time with my children. And sometimes my children would travel with them to India and to other places. And there was one. His name is His Holiness Ganapati Swami, who was. Who was coming there quite often. And my children grew up, looking up to him and learning from him. And later on, when, one time, just a couple years ago, my youngest son, Gopal, he wrote a letter to him. And I happened to read that letter, and I was quite shocked. And that's when I realized what an impact these people can have on our children. And I'll read you to you this letter because it's really nice. Gopal wrote, "Recently I was greatly missing you. I was thinking how wonderful you are and how kind and merciful you have been to me. I was feeling bad that I have not written to you in such a long time. I'm very sorry. This year was my first year as a DPhil student and it was quite demanding. I read your Vyas Puja offering to Srila Prabhupada this year and somehow it really touched me. It also brought back many memories of your visits to Boise and your selfless preaching in Boise, both in the university and to our family. Some of the best memories of my life are being with you in Boise. When I had the chance to go out with you to the book tables, to Harinams and evening home programs. I also remember the time when you took my brother and me to Vrindavan, Mayapur and the Science and Religion Conference in Calcutta. All these things continue to stay with me and I continue to hanker for your association again. When I read your Vyas Puja offering, I was thinking that maybe, if Krishna is merciful, in my next life I could once again assist you in some small way in your Sankirtan, your insignificant servant, Gopal Haridas." And that's when I realized that, sometimes we take these things for granted, but because children are looking up for role models, and if you give them the right role models, they always want to be like that. So this is the last one before we finish this section. It's called deity worship. And it's a very important one for our children because, I love to quote this one quote by Bhaktivinoda Thakur. He wrote in Jaya Dharma, he talked about how children should grow up with deities, because he said deity worship is the foundation of humanity. I'll read you this quote directly from that book. "The religions which have no provision for deity worship face the danger that those children born into the religion and those just beginning spiritual life, both of whom may have little or no understanding or deep faith in Godhead, may become overly materialistic and even develop aversion towards the Supreme Lord as a result of the absence of a deity form upon which to fix their minds. Therefore, deity worship is the foundation of religion for general humanity." And the reason he explains is because deities, help our children to focus on a form of the Lord, and they see Krishna as a person. Just like they would see a doll as a person, they would see Krishna as a person and take care of that. And it also helps them to make, to develop good habits, where right from the beginning we can train them to offer everything to the deities, even clothes and whatever new clothes that come in the house, food, of course. And it's of course, when my children are small, I introduced deity worship very early in their life, when they were 3 and 5 years old. And they had very small Gornithai deities, about 6 inch tall. and they would take care. See, children have to do something. You know, when they're that little, they have to play. Or this is a nice way to do to dovetail their playing tendency, is to take care of deities. And we would take worship them for like 2 or 3 hours every day, where they would, you know, bathe them, dress them, you know, ornament them, put them back on the altar, and then we would offer food, do arati. Just the whole process took like 2 to 3 hours every day. And it was amazing when I would see them completely absorbed in that. And these are, this is nice, because generally children, you know, they just waste time. You know, they just do here and there. They play with frivolous things that they really don't need to. So
one of the benefits of deity worship is that if a child does deity worship right from the start, then it develops a foundation where they will always see Krishna as a person. In other words, becoming impersonalistic becomes very difficult afterwards, because you've right from the start, you've come to see Krishna that as a person. The nature of a child is that they automatically personalize everything, right? You give them a doll, they'll deal with it like a person. You give them a little animal to play with, they'll deal with it like a person. It's only as we grow older, we learn that, oh, this is not a person, we should not deal with it like a person. You cannot talk to your Lego pieces. That's not right. That's crazy. So we learn that as we grow up. But children, they automatically see everything as a person. So if they see Krishna as a person right from the start, then it develops a very deep impression in their heart that Krishna is someone who will listen to my prayers. Krishna is someone I can go to and offer whatever I want. And they'll develop that so quickly and so strongly that they'll end up guiding the parents on how to do it. You know, the children will remind the parents, did you offer this yet? Anything they eat, they'll first put on the altar first. And this can start even 2-3 years old. A child will remember, they'll take a bite out, like my son recently, he took a bite out of an apple and said, oh, I didn't offer it, and then took the apple and put it in front of Krishna. So it's unclean, right? Not clean. But it's okay. He has home deities, it's no problem. Krishna is kind. So his gesture means he was learning that this is how I should treat Krishna, that I forgot Krishna should get it first. I eat it, so Krishna also likes to eat it. The child learns, oh, I really want to eat this, but I have to wait because Krishna is eating it first. It teaches self-control, tolerance, cleanliness, all kinds of good qualities. No, you can't touch the deity right now. You just put your finger in your mouth. Let's go wash your hands first. Again and again we do that. And it feels like, oh my God, 100 times I had washed his hands already. But it's that process that basically inculcates these good behaviors in the heart. Because they say that everything you need to know in life, you learn by the age of 5. By the age of 5, you've learned that. And those habits you see in a child where the family is doing deity worship, they grow up as little pujaris right from the start. Right? They behave like that, they know how to do that, and so on and so forth. So it's very good habits for our Krishna consciousness. It's very good personal habits that deity worship teaches us. Some manner of regulation in life becomes there.
So this is actually the last one in the first section. And it's the early years, how to educate our children up to the age of 5. You know, most of us are thinking about their training starting 5. You know, those are considered the formal years of school, after the age of 5. So, but we have to remember that the first 5 years are very, very important. Now in America, they're discovering these first years. And they're doing research on those first 5 years, and they're calling it the lost years. In other words, they're realizing how these five years, whatever the child goes through and experiences, you can pretty much predict what he's going to be in the rest of his life. Very, very important years. And of course, for very babies, we can, you know, if we are devotees and we are strong devotees and we do everything that Prabhupada told us to do, then we can. The children grow up in that environment where they're watching us, you know, do, sing, chant, do deity worship. And growing up, even as infants in that environment, has a very big effect on them later on in their life. So So and then for later on for toddlers and preschoolers, you know, we Prabhupada gave very very nice instructions of on how we can train our children, you know, in both in very very effective ways. He was so he really emphasized the fact that children should grow up playing Krishna conscious games, you know, associating with Krishna. We should not underestimate the effect that childhood play has on children. They reflect what they play. Children, so in other words, if they're playing with Krishna dolls, if they're playing with Krishna conscious games or toys, then it's like associating with Krishna. And you can see in how Prabhupada, in different purports in the Srimad Bhagavatam, he talks about the examples of our acharyas and how they grew up, and that's why they became their life was so impressive. It's because they grew up playing with dolls, you know, Krishna dolls. They grew up focusing on that. And he gives the example of Parikshit Maharaj, Yudhishthir Maharaj, and his own example, how when he was 4 or 5 years old, his father gave him a set of Radha Krishna deities and how he would imitate the activities in the Radha Govinda temple and you know, put them into practice with his sister. So so it's important that we not underestimate this. He said for children in indoor games, we should try to give them simple household items to play with, like, you know, spoons and cups where children are imitating a Krishna, you know, cooking for Krishna. And of course we have other things now, you know, like Play-Doh and, you know, making them make jewelry for Krishna. So many nice things. And then for outdoor games, he said, children should pretend to play Krishna conscious, imitate Krishna from the Krishna book. Like, you know, they become cowherd boys and cows go to the forest where Krishna kills the demon, like this. So, he said, children should not waste time because even though that becomes very difficult for us as parents, you know, where, you know, we have so much to do and we can't always be with them. But just by the fact that we are doing these Krishna conscious things, if they simply stay with us and follow us everywhere, they will be taking a lot of good examples. So I can read you one quote that is really, really nice about Prabhupada talking about how children should be raised with that. He said that children should be always instructed by taking advantage of their playful mood and teaching them to play Krishna games, like become cowherd boys, cows, peacocks, demons. And in this way, if they always think of Krishna by playing just like they are actually present in association with Krishna, then they will become Krishna conscious very quickly. In addition, there should be a little ABC, then prasadam, then worshipping the deity, then more playing Krishna games, some kirtan, a little more ABC, like that. In this way, always keeps their mind and bodies engaged in different activities because children are restless by nature, so they will want to change often. See, Prabhupada didn't want our children to play with like artificial toys that supercharge the brain, that kind of toys. He wanted them to actually experiment with simple things, household things, you know, that our grandparents have been, you know, doing that.
So we'll stop at this point. And this covers the first section of the seminar, which is about creating the right home environment and personal practices that are conducive to a Krishna conscious education. At this point, if there are questions that people have about the material we've discussed especially, then we'll be happy to take these questions before moving on to the next section. Yes.
Hare Krishna. Prabhuji, you have mentioned about prasadam Prabhuji, in case if the children have any kind of disease, like, I mean, nowadays the children are getting early stages like diabetes and some kind of diseases. So that time we can't think about that. Every time the prasadam will come over, sometimes if the people are very hungry, and even though if it is that hotel has any kind of thing and meat it or anything, if the person is struggling for that kind of things or situation, what is a good way to good way because what is the remedies to take the steps? So if the person having any kind of diabetes, or because if the person having any diabetes, initially he should take every intervals of the food. And because if he has a high increasing of insulin, and if he taking tablets, any other things, compulsory he should eat a food. So that kind of situation, because we will offer every time food, every intervals, like 12 o'clock, we have a timings of the food offered to the Krishna every time. So if that person is having that kind of things, what is the remedy to take the step? If we go outside, if we go outside to eat something, he's feeling hungry. So what is the steps to take?
Yeah, I mean, I don't have personal experience of this, but what I've seen from other members of my family or so on is generally those with some kind of condition like that, like diabetes, are anyway very careful about their diet. No, they regulate their diet very carefully. And for such people, eating a lot of processed food of different kinds is actually very risky, because they don't know what they're consuming, and it can cause the sugar to go up and so on.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think there's no problem in them taking the precautions they need and offering that to Krishna and eating Krishna prasad. So, I mean, I guess your question is in terms of the regular timings of the offerings? Because the timings can vary. In a home situation, you just offer, or you offer things in advance, so you have for the full day, you can pack and everything. If you're in an emergency situation or a difficult situation where you need to have food and the only thing available is in a restaurant, then you have to eat. Means the point is we have to do what's practical, right? We have to do what's practical. Means if the body is demanding it and it's a difficult situation, then we have to do what's necessary. But in general, I found that actually people with those types of conditions tend to be more careful and regulated about what they eat than all of us on average, you know?
And one more thing, Prabhuji, and if we go some kind of hotels, they will be having onion and garlic. Especially my child is asking about why we should not eat onion garlic, and what is because sometimes people were think sometimes people will think onion garlic is giving something. I mean, because I'm so sorry, because about onion garlic, I know here Vaishnavas, all the nobody eats onion garlic, but typically some people are eat onion garlic. But doctor will say that onion will give some kind of good things to in the body, and garlic will give the heart related things if we eat. In point is, so many questions and harassments is coming like that. Why we should not eat it? And it should be clear picture about the kids and even the adults also. It's very it's common people telling that why it should compulsory to eat, but there is basic reason behind should give to them. So I need that basic reason that why we should not eat onion garlic, and why should it should be very strong reason. Even people, because why I'm telling, kids are going to the other places and they are lot of interaction with both a devotee and non-devotee. Devotee knows everything, but even sometimes they can't explain to them that kind of reason.
I understand. So it's the fundamental reason is that the basically our diet is one that is sattvic in nature, right? That increases the good qualities and the peacefulness of the mind and the body, and suppresses the lower urges, the lower chakras of the body, like lust and anger and passion and so on. And Krishna says very clearly in Bhagavad Gita that when we eat food that is too pungent or too sour or too sweet or too hot or too strong in flavor, then that is in the mode of passion. It causes the passionate nature of a human being to come up. So eating onions and garlic is not like, okay, it's not like eating meat. It means it's not like you're killing an animal or something like that. No blood is flowing. But because we're practicing to be yogis, basically, we're practicing to be yogis, then a yogi's lifestyle is whatever is helpful to control the mind, the senses, and the body. And certain types of foods, they incite the mode of passion. And the way you can see this is just by consuming onions and garlic, the body gives off such a strong odor, and that odor makes you unfit to worship the deity of the Lord, because you cannot go on the altar with that kind of smell coming. means you can, if you don't eat onions and garlic, you can notice the difference immediately. If you're eating it regular, you don't smell anything additional. But even you don't eat it, someone walks in the door who's recently had a meal with onions and garlic, you can smell it from that distance. Right? You can immediately there. So in that state of mind, in that state of body, you cannot come in front of the deity and worship the deity. And because we're practicing, like we said, deity worship, and we're practicing to be yogis, that's why we control our diet in that regard. Similarly, we should control not eating food that is way too hot or too sour or too pungent or too many things like that. That's also in the mode of passion. So that's the idea behind onion and garlic. It's not as great of a sin as it is eating meat, but it's basically part of our diet to help make it nicely controlled. In terms of the health benefits, that's not a very strong argument. The reason is because many things in this world have health benefits. They say drinking a glass of red wine every day has health benefits. Eating fish has health benefits. Even eating eggs on certain way occasions can have health benefits. Chicken soup has some health benefits. So the point is, if our main goal was to make the body strong and healthy, then we should be eating all of those things. But that's not our main goal. Our main goal is to keep the body healthy and operational so that we can serve Krishna. Right? So that we can serve Krishna. All these rakshasas in the past, they used to be very, very strong and healthy, right? By eating what? Human flesh. Because it's so high in protein and so good for you, right? They become so powerful. But we won't eat it, right? Because that's not against our values. So what if it makes you strong? But we won't eat it. So in the same way, just becoming strong and healthy is not the point. Okay, if the doctor is really prescribing and seriously you have to have garlic for health purposes, then they have garlic pills that you can eat and they digest inside and it gets rid of the odor. You suggest to someone, oh, eat the garlic pills. Will they be satisfied? No. Because they're not eating it just for health reasons, right? They're eating it for the taste. Health is an excuse only. See, we're not eating onions and garlic, and everyone's so nice and healthy. Basically, no extra health problems we have. We have the usual health problems that everyone has, right?
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Yeah, no problem. Yes. Oh, sorry.
Thanks a lot, Prabhuji and Mataji. That's an awesome and enlightening seminar. So I have, we have two boys, 3.5 and 1.5. And they are always trying to engage with us in the deity worship. We do it regularly in the morning and the evening. But because of their age, I'm paranoid to the core that they would hurt the deities, like, you know, hurt the altar. Many times they would get up in the morning and they have not taken bath and they would like to be part of it. So, I mean, from your experience, like, you know, if you can give us an idea, like, you know, how do you guys deal? Like, you know, I mean, you both have kids. I mean, you had two boys and you have the same age kids. How do you deal with that? Especially the, you know, enforcing the rules and regulation on the kids for the deity worship.
So I guess I can speak because I'm currently in the same stage of child rearing as you are. Both of my kids are 1 year younger than both of your kids. And we have exactly the same problem. As in the older one, he's 2.5 and he wants to be part of the deity worship. And our Gornithai deities, we got, just when we got married, they're such that they're completely painted, fully painted. Mm-hmm. And so you cannot bathe them, really, and they get scratched very, very easily. Even by us, they get scratched easily if we're not careful. So we're also very nervous. So now he's come to a point that he wants to do seva himself. So we're getting him small deities of his own, brass deities, that he can bathe and that he can dress and he can take care of. And so there's basically two options. Either you make this your own standard for your deities at home, or if there's some problem, as in they're marble deities and they'll fall and break, or they're, like I said, painted, or neem deities and they can break. If there's some problem, then you can get a separate set of deities that they can worship. But the thing we have to always remember is that when Krishna is at home, he's very, very kind, and it's very different mood than in the temple. Means at home, Krishna wants to be a member of your family. He doesn't want to be something separate. Okay, he's in a closet and he's there, done puja and finished. He wants to be part of every aspect of our life. If we're eating, he wants the same meal. If whatever we're eating, if it's simple rice, he'll be satisfied with simple rice. As long as he's getting what everyone else is getting. It's just like children, right? Children, they don't mind what kind of food. As long as I'm getting what mommy and daddy are eating, I'm fine, right? So that's what the deities want. They want to be part of our life. If that means the kids are there, they want to be part of the kids' life also. And Krishna is actually pleased by that. Right? He's actually pleased by that. So, okay, it's a little struggle. We want some standard. We get them to wash their hands nicely, properly. Okay, now you come and do your puja. But if you set up the bathing situation for them, they'll do it so nicely. You know, he has this little deity and he'll sit there for 20 minutes, you know, bathing, and then he'll pour the water, the same water he's bathed, he'll pour it back again on them, then he'll empty the water, then pour again. And Krishna's getting long bath, you know. But it's okay, it means it's his mood, it's his seva, and Krishna's there, very merciful like that. Of course, we don't want to do this with Radha Krishna deities. We should get Gornithai deities or Jagannath deities. They're very merciful, very kind. And Prabhupada even said for Gornithai deities, he said, you can distribute them on the street as good luck dolls, he said. To anyone, you can give as good luck dolls. And if they say, oh, how do you get good luck? He said, well, put them, and then if you want, you can bring some flowers and put it at their feet. This will increase your good luck. And if you want even more good luck, then you can burn some incense in front of them every once in a while. He said, in this way, Gornithai will be so pleased, they'll give you mercy.
So just a small kind of a follow-up on that. Like, you know, many times, like, you know, if I try to bathe them around 7 o'clock in the morning, so they are good to go and all. But many times, you know, they're not ready to even take a bath at 7 o'clock. But, you know, they want to do deity worship. So as a shortcut, is like I just throw a bunch of, like, drops of Ganga Jal. And say, okay, now you're good to go because you want to do something. And I don't know if that's the right way to kind of move forward.
Yeah, no, I would consider that very reasonable. It's up to you to set your standard, you see. At home, it's up to you to set your standard. And to me, that sounds like a very nice compromise to allow your children to participate when other things are not practical. Then you purify them in some way. I do something similar with my 2.5-year-old. And we chant some mantra he really likes, Roma Pavitra Pavitrova, and he stands there and he sprinkles. He feels very good, you know. And then we do it, oh, you didn't wash your hands. He comes, washes his hands. Then he can help.
Thank you.
Mataji, okay, we'll complete the... Okay, you can.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu and Mataji. Thank you so much. This is so wonderful. my question was, my son actually is chanting and he does lots, you know, many things. He's just because of devotee association and he has his own deities. Recently, I mean, just because, you know, I wanted him to get into a little sport so, you know, he can have some good thing. So he started playing tennis. So now he loves tennis to such an extent that he wants to be a tennis player sometime. So when we have this conversation, I tell him that think about it if it's Krishna conscious. And then he tells me, you know, I'm sure Krishna must be playing ball games in Goloka. So if I do very well here, I can go play with him there. So I tell him that, but still, we don't know whether we really want to think about becoming number one and things like that. But he just loves to play. He goes, you know, whenever he has time, he'll go to, we have a tennis court next, very close, and he'll go play with some of his friends. So my question is, for Krishna conscious kids, you know, he's trying to chant 7 rounds now. So my concern is that I don't want him to go away from Krishna. So do you think that it is okay to encourage? Because that is something that is there in him now, you know. He just loves to play. You know, even as a kid, he'd always love to play anything to do with the ball. And then he'll tell me stories from Bhagavatam, which I narrated. He'll tell me, you remember that demon that Krishna picked up from the root of the tree and he hit the demon? Maybe that's how cricket started. You know, all these concocted things. He'll make up with related to whatever he loves. And he'll tell, oh, Krishna, I'll talk to Dr. Krishna. So I love both of you. He's 10 now.
It's natural. At a certain age, it's natural for children to have those types of aspirations. You know, the kids at that age, they want to grow up to be a policeman, 90% of kids. But you see what percentage actually become policemen, you know. And 90% want to be firefighters, and the parents say, yes, yes, you'll be firefighter one day. And they grow up and they become a software engineer. So means at some age, it's natural. And the fact that he's connecting it to Krishna is very good. I think the thing you have to be more concerned about is the type of association he's getting on and off the court. That's the thing to make sure that association, to talk to him about it, what is he learning there and so on. if that enthusiasm, that passion for sports continues at a later age where he actually, you know, it's sort of into the high school years and so on, then it's something that really at that age he's old enough to actually think and talk about it. And at that point, then the parents need to really talk to the child and figure out, okay, what are your goals in life? Because then pursuing sports can take a huge physical and academic toll on the child as well. So that's the point at which it needs to be questioned. But most children grow out of that before they hit that age, you know, before they hit that age. There's one girl in our Bhakti Riksha program in Virginia. She was really into swimming quite a lot, and became very, very good at it. You know, up to like state champion and so on, really good. And the parents were encouraging, and she really wanted to go on and be professional and so on. But at some point, it was her own decision also, and the parents also. She decided, I'm not going to pursue it further, because it was coming to a point where it was really a choice. Either I can excel at my studies or I can excel at sports, but it wasn't working both ways. And then at that point, she decided she wasn't going to do this as a career for sure. She didn't really want to, you know, there's a very tiny percentage, very, very tiny percentage of people who can actually maintain themselves and succeed at that level in sports to make it, and the rest just fizzle out after some time. Right? But at this age, I, my feeling is that it's something that's natural, and he's connecting with to Krishna, and you know, if it continues after a certain age, then you can discuss.
Thank you, Prabhu. Yeah, when you mentioned about you know, they wanted to become police officers, so I'm just remembering that, yeah, there was a time when he wanted to be the firefighter, when he wanted to be when he also wanted to be the president when the elections were going on, when he was 8 year old. Then he would tell him that, so he does tell, you know, can you imagine if I become a president or a tennis player and I become very famous and I'm initiated devotee, everybody in the world will get to know about Krishna consciousness.
So he's thinking in the right way. He's thinking, I mean, and there's so many, there's, you can, in Krishna Leela you can find policeman roles, you can find firefighter roles, you can, Krishna was president of Dwarka, so it's all of that is there, you know, in Shastra. So any desire a child has, you connect it to Krishna, they can feel good about it.
Prabhupada was not against children. Prabhupada was not against children doing, you know, doing different types of jobs or occupations. See, he said, whatever varna or ashram they may go to, the main criteria was that they should be Krishna conscious, and they should have good character. And that's what the Gurukula training is all about, is developing good character. So, but he actually wanted these children to be trained well and to become future leaders of society. He said, how can anybody who doesn't know the purpose of life help others? They can't even help themselves. So how they can... And he gave the example of, you know, many, you know, these great souls in our sampradaya who were great leaders, but also they were so God-conscious. So he wanted, you know, he wanted them to excel. So this is nice that your child is thinking like that. There's actually nothing wrong with that.
Yeah. And it is a fact that ball games are mentioned in Krishna book, as Krishna is playing ball games. Prabhupada says ball games are natural for children to play. What he didn't appreciate was very violent and physically intense games that were super competitive, you know. So like games that like American football and rugby, Prabhupada was not very happy with them, because he said it was too demanding, physically demanding and emotionally demanding on a child. So much energy being spent in that type of competitiveness and that type of physical activity.
Yeah, I remember one time I was worried about the physical, you know, how much physical exercise they were getting, and I enrolled them in the city soccer group, and they did it for 2 or 3 months, but then, like Radhika was saying about association, that's one thing you have to worry about. The association that they were getting, you know, after the game and before the game was really bad. And, you know, in the locker rooms and things like that, dirty language, association with the opposite sex and things like that. And that's when we decided to drop out. So this is something you have to just watch out, not the game itself, you know, the, you know.
You record it.
Oh, this one.
Yeah, you should.
Yeah, I usually try to be the volunteer to do anything in any activity that he does, and you know, bake stuff. Mm. And I do have some other Matajis, and if it's in the classroom, and you know, try to be the you know person around, just make sure that everything that is served is Krishna Prasad and for other kids too. So you know, it just gets easy.
That's good.
Yeah, thank you.
In the back.
I have two questions. One is regarding like have giving children processed foods like biscuits and breads and juices. What are your views on that? And second question is regarding the sports, like the games you said, like outdoor games, Krishna conscious outdoor games. Can you give some practical examples of what you played or something like that, which is easy for parents to play with the kids?
Okay, I'll just answer the second one first. In terms of Prabhupada approved many types of games for our children. And they were, you know, games like swimming and wrestling, yeah, pretty much like
and
that.
And ball games.
And ball games. So
And role playing. As children, I remember we used to spend hours reenacting scenes from Mahabharata, Krishna book, Ramayana, becoming different characters. These are things that Krishna used to do as a child. Caitanya Mahaprabhu did as a child also. Prabhupada did as a child. So these are all very natural. In other words, Prabhupada encouraged natural games that children do automatically. All they need is some few sticks and stones and they're playing these games. The games he didn't appreciate a lot were either the very violent or else the very electronically stimulating games. He didn't appreciate those at all. His children have been growing up just fine with playing the exact same things that are around the house that the parents have. And in fact, you see this for a fact. You buy a new toy for the child, they play excitedly for like 2 days, and then they never see it again, right? And they're back in the kitchen banging on pots and pans. I'm saying for small ones. And they grow up, then they start, you know, bows and arrows and for boys and doing things and like that. So. Oh, the other question you had, what was it?
Processed foods like biscuits. And
oh,
all
yeah.
Those.
Yeah, processed foods, I mean, just not from a Krishna conscious perspective, but you know, from just a health perspective, that processed foods, the more processed foods that children eat, the greater chance they have for weight gain, obesity, later on in life, high cholesterol, heart disease, all these problems, high sodium. So processed foods in general for anyone, devotee or non-devotee, is something that there's, you know, a great awareness in the general public and medical community and so on, that is something to be minimized as much as possible. Now, in terms of eating bread and so on, also the same point applies, that when we eat grains cooked by non-devotees, then we're basically accepting their consciousness into our own mind and body. So it's not so difficult if we are like some bread. Just recently, we have a very good devotee family in where we live, and they have a small child and so on. And for years, they were eating prasadam nicely, but they were really attached to the bread, you know, the morning bread or whatever. But gradually now, since they got a child, they've decided, no, we have to practice nicely. And they bought a bread machine, and you know, you put the ingredients in, you set it at night. In the morning, you wake up to the smell of fresh bread. And frankly, it's very easy, very simple, very straightforward. In that way, you can offer that to the deities nicely, proudly, that Krishna, this is something I cooked with good, pure ingredients. Most types of breads outside have mono and diglycerides in them. 99% of breads have mono and diglycerides, which are basically meat products. These days, to find purity in anything is nearly impossible. So it's best if we can do all of these things in simple solutions, you know, simple solutions. Processed foods are not really necessary for upkeep. There's one question that was in the back, and then we can come up here.
Yes, Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, Mataji. It was a very nice talk, thank you. You know, as I listen and hear today, I sort of wonder if what you're trying to say is something more about teaching kids to be more discerning. You know, I mean, to have a question about onions and garlic or to understand which sport, I think part of the teaching is underlying is to know material modes of nature, to discern the material object, to understand what it is that you're interfacing with. You know, today you spoke about a TV or a computer. When that child grows up, it will be something else. Mm. It's not the object, it's the understanding what the object is doing to you, and the parent has to model that. So if they watch TV and don't allow the child to, then it becomes that it gives them actually more confusing message, right? To have phones with you all the time, putting on even one movie and watching that. So in my mind, it's even more in depth to teach something more deeper, you know? And I think children from age of 3 or 4 can start to why are you watching this program? What does it do for you? What is it making you think? You know, this sort of inquiry. And then they themselves would choose not to do this. And that is a better force. So I just want to clarify, you know, because sometimes the tapas and austerity, if it causes disturbance in the mind, then it's much more harmful. Or it disturbs others. My son, only about a month ago, in fact, it was just before Christmas, I think, at his school, they were talking about some subject, and I actually don't remember what it was, but he stood up and said, oh, meat eating is cruel to the whole class. And everybody, well, meat eaters accept him, you know? So, and of course the teacher wrote me email, you know, that all the other, everybody was upset. So, but for me, my teaching for him is to realize the world he lives in. You know, it's not his position to always be the person to give out this, bring advice, right? It's maybe that's not the right time or the right place. So there's this moderation. He's 11, so he has to learn to moderate and know when he does something, right? Mm-hmm. And I think Srila Prabhupada also was, when he first came to the U.S., he lived somewhere, and I can't remember, but it was in the Midwest. And he stayed with a family. They were meat eaters, but he respected that. I mean, I heard the story about this from the temple here. So I believe that. You know, so I think in each case, there's a discernment on the part of the human being, understanding who you're disturbing, your internal disturbance. So, what are your thoughts on this, and how did you evolve that teaching to the children? So, am I making sense?
Yes, actually, you are. You know, it makes sense what you're saying, and that's the whole idea for me, was to give this all-round education where we just don't focus on the practice, but also, like you said, the discernment, where we actually make a deep study of the Shastra according to the level. And that would be the next part of our seminar, which is coming up, which gives the children the intelligence to understand. And from very early on, we inculcate in them the capacity to distinguish with, you know, to reason. You know, we sometimes think that should be left to the college people who go to college. But really, that kind of reasoning and logical, questioning comes very early. In other words, children, are able to understand, of course, through the study of Shastra, because a Shastra book goes beyond just a moral science book. This is good. You have to honor your father and mother, and that's it. That's the end of the story. It goes beyond that. Shastra goes deeply into deep analysis of why we want to be like that, you know, and why it makes sense. And this is what Prabhupada's books does to our children. It gives them, like you said, your child so wonderfully, he stood up, right, and said that. And it's this kind of faith and this, that confidence that we want to develop in our children as to why they're devotees, why they want to. And that comes through our next part of our seminar, which is through Shastra reading.
What time is it over? I forget.
1:15.
Oh, okay.
So there's 25 minutes. So, Jana, should we continue with the questions here? Do you want to do Bhagavad Gita? We have about 25, 30 minutes.
Some coffee here. Let's continue. I really think so, yeah.
To the Bhagavad.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We have about 25 minutes left in this session here. And we really want to cover one particular section of the next part before lunch. Otherwise, it's going to be too much material for the next part. So I know there are many questions in hands there. And these period question answers, I know we won't be able to cover everyone. But we'll have question answers again after the next session. You can bring up some questions there again, okay? So if it's okay, we'll just move on to this next point. I think it's very important, and this last question was a nice transition to it. And then we break for lunch, and then when we come back, we'll have more time for questions and the third part of the seminar. So books are the basis. This is about the academic curriculum. And this is this first part that we're going to talk about before lunch is, I would say, the most important contribution that we hope to give in this seminar. And so I know it's before lunch and kids and families start to get restless and the stomach is growling and so on, but please try to especially focus for this part because this is really what we hope you'll carry away from this. And the idea behind this is that we want to give our children an education that's based upon Shastra, specifically on the study of Srimad Bhagavatam. And I will just begin this by reading a few quotes by Srila Prabhupada on Srimad Bhagavatam, which hopefully will get us inspired about this. He says, "Our students specifically, they should take care of reading Srimad Bhagavatam. We have therefore prescribed in our school, Dallas, and from the very beginning, if they begin education with Bhagavad Gita and then come to Srimad Bhagavatam and read the whole literature, then they will be more than MA, PhD. Even astronomy, astrology, politics, sociology, atomic theory, everything is there. Therefore, if we study Srimad Bhagavatam very carefully, then you get all knowledge completely. Throughout the whole world, whatever knowledge is there is in the Srimad Bhagavatam. If one simply reads this Srimad Bhagavatam, his education is the topmost. If one studies Srimad Bhagavatam, he is well versed in every subject matter."
So Prabhupada stressed the reading, the study of two subjects for the children in the Gurukula, and that was English and Sanskrit, because he said that because he emphasized the study of his books in the Gurukuls. He said that would be, like I said earlier, that Prabhupada was so always emphasizing the study of Shastra for our children because he felt they would get everything, like he's saying in this quote, every knowledge of every subject in the world. So, and this is what we found. I mean, of course, this the result came much later. And initially when I was doing the Shastra with them, I did not know that this result would be there. You know, like I said, my faith developed as time went on. But what the study of Srimad Bhagavatam did was it prepared them both academically and spiritually. Okay, spiritually we all know that Srimad Bhagavatam, Prabhupada said, is that it's like pure devotional service. He said actually that's the only thing you can do, and you could qualify to go back to Godhead. But the only reason I'm giving you other things is because you cannot read all day. So that's and also he also said Srimad Bhagavatam gives you every psychological situation in the world. In other words, if you, in order to tackle with this material world and the problems that we face, the way to tackle with be is to learn the lessons from Srimad Bhagavatam. And for our children especially, it's very, very valuable because children cannot take like pure philosophy. It's hard for them to sit down for hours and understand the philosophy. But if we present it in the form of stories, like in Srimad Bhagavatam, you know, the Srimad Bhagavatam is full of stories, then they can actually enjoy it and get the same lessons. And as they read the stories of these great acharyas, especially child heroes like Dhruva and Prahlad, this character of these heroes rubs on them. And as they get older, they are more capable of understanding the instructions. And they take it. And you can see, as you teach them, how they identify with these people and they want to be like them. So and academically also, Srimad Bhagavatam is very powerful because it gives us the tools, the skills that we want to inculcate in our children. You know, we have to teach them certain skills in life, right? Certain concepts. And that's what primary education is all about, where we're teaching our children some skills and some concepts. But here, what we are saying is that we teach these same skills from Prabhupada's books. In other words, instead of some other books, you know, outside books, we teach them from Prabhupada's books. In other words, from the spiritual books. And this way, the skills that they learn, it becomes, you know, more valuable because they also benefit spiritually. So today, in today's world, you know, the teachers and the parents, they're trying to inculcate in our children, you know, good reasoning, good analytical abilities, and this is clearly found in Prabhupada's books. You know, we can see how you take any portion of Srimad Bhagavatam, and you can see how deep it goes. You know, like, you know, modern history just talks about different rulers and what they did in terms of worldly power and things like that. But the Vedic history is talking about, you know, great souls, great leaders who are such great examples, you know, and to study them requires a lot of thinking, right? You take the story of Parikshit Maharaj, it's not just a story of what happened, but also there are questions being raised, and deep questions being raised, which requires deep answers. You know, why did he throw the snake around the Rishi's neck? Why did he not reverse the curse that was given to him, even though he had the power to do so? So by reading these stories, the children are getting good reasoning, logical abilities. And as we sit down and we discuss with them, they also improve in other ways, like good communication skills, debate, you know, because I would be playing the devil's advocate with them, you know, questioning them, you know, relating it to private life, practical life, and also to things happening around the world. These very same skills that we are trying so hard to teach them is so easily done through Srimad Bhagavatam. And with the result that in just a few years of just daily reading Srimad Bhagavatam with them, they were able to actually develop very good language skills, comprehension skills. And when they went to college, they had not studied any of those subjects, like geography, history, psychology, anthropology, all those subjects. But they were able to do it without any problem. In other words, the level of Srimad Bhagavatam is higher than any basic level college course.
Sometimes, you know, as devotees, we become so used to the philosophy of Krishna consciousness that we take it for granted. You know, it's become something normal. Oh, okay, Krishna has three energies, right? The material energy, the spiritual energy, the marginal energy. There's three different aspects to the Supreme Lord. There's the impersonal, there's the localized Paramatma, there's Bhagavan. All these things just become, you know, like, but they're actually very, very difficult and abstract philosophical ideas. And to understand them requires a level of thinking that now the educational system and the workforce is basically looking for in people as problem solvers and as critical thinkers. I remember once I was at a conference and sitting next to someone, and you know, they knew I was a devotee or not like them. And so he said, so what do you guys believe in, actually, the Hare Krishnas? And I said, I started off by saying, well, the basics, that we believe that we're not this material body, that all the labels that we put on the body are not actually us, we're the spirit soul, and the spirit soul is eternal. And then I was going on to talk about other things, how God is a person. And he said, stop, hold on right there. He said, what did you say? He said, that we're not this body, we're the spirit soul? Wow, that's deep, man. That's really deep. And I was sitting at an academic conference with someone, you know, PhD and so. And at that point, I remember thinking, yeah, that is deep. You know, I've been rattling this off thinking that, basic philosophies, what difference does it make? The idea that this whole world is energy, it's Krishna's material energy, right? To think of this as an abstract emanation, like the sun rays come from the sun. That takes a lot of philosophical work to get to that level of abstraction. But we do it in regular Bhagavatam classes. And our children can do it at very young ages. You look at vocabulary levels that you find in Prabhupada's books. That vocabulary level is not, the average person doesn't have it. I remember also as a child, my parents were running Govinda's restaurant for some time. And at the restaurant, we used to introduce people to the food and so on and take their cash money and clean the tables. But at the end, if they were interested, we'd show them some of Prabhupada's books. There was a bookshelf. And one time, a couple was interested, and I was excitedly telling them, you know, this is what it's talking about and so on. But after a while, I realized they weren't listening to what I was saying. The one, the wife turned to the husband and said, wow, did you hear his vocabulary? He said, ecstatic? What does that mean? Transcendental? And we throw around these words like ecstatic and transcendental and superior and internal and external. And this is not average vocabulary, right? It's not average vocabulary. Prabhupada's vocabulary level is really, really high, right? Really high. SAT, ACT stuff, very simple in comparison to what words like demeanor. And I remember studying once Bhagavad Gita, we would underline the words, the vocabulary words that were difficult, so we could look them up in the dictionary. And I remember it was O Sion of Bharata, right? S-C-I-O-N. What does Sion mean? So we looked it up, we learned it, figured it out. Now you talk to the average person, there's a Toyota model, right? That's called Sion. It's a part of it. You ask them, what does Sion mean? Does anyone know? Says, no one knows what Sion means. But we use the word on a regular basis, right? Sion. O Sion of Bharata. So the point being is that we should not underestimate the gift that Prabhupada has given us in these books. When he says that by studying Srimad Bhagavatam, one will become more than MA, PhD, it's something that he means very seriously. Right? It's very much true. I'll just give you one more experience or example. I remember the first time when I went to college, our story was a little bit unusual in that we entered the university at quite an early age. And when I first started at the university, I was just 12 years old. And I went into the class, I still remember the first day of the first class I took. It was such a, you know, like, nervous. I was so nervous, and I didn't know what to expect and so on. The class, as it had worked out, I had originally... there was someone at the restaurant, Govinda's, who used to come, and he knew we were homeschooling. And he said, you know, he told my parents, Ravi's level of English is pretty good. Why don't you register him for a course at the local university? You can get admission for one course, and this way it'll supplement your homeschool education. And so that's, my parents thought, oh, that's a good idea. Let's try. And we went there and showed them some records of what I had written, some articles for BTG and test scores that we were taking regularly and so on. And the admissions officer says, okay, you can go in for one English writing course, English 101. So I went, I was happy I went there to register. But as it turned out, because I was not a degree-seeking student, all the courses were full by the time I went to register, all the 101 courses. So the person who had suggested this, he was actually the chair of the English department. He said, no, I know, Ravi, I know you. Instead of 101, why don't you take the second semester English course, 102? So I thought, okay, this is college level, but I'll give it a try. Went to register, and it was also full. And so I thought, okay, it's not worth it. He said, no, don't worry about it. He came back and said, why don't you sign up for the first semester English honors writing course, 111. No, just do it. You'll be fine. I went to register, and it wasn't being offered that semester. So then what? He said, sign up for the second semester English honors writing course. That's being offered, 112. And indeed, I got into that. The first day I went to class, I will never forget. I was so nervous. And all these students there who were twice my age, and the teacher handed out the syllabus. And because this is an honors writing course, it was all classical literature. Homer's Iliad and Odyssey in translation, Shakespeare's Hamlet, Bless Mi Ultima by Rudolfo Anaya, different Mexican Chicano writers, all classical English literature. I was so nervous. I thought, how am I going to do this? I've never even read any Shakespeare. You know, we had spent all our time reading Bhagavatam. And so we started, so the assignment started. Every week we had to read a book and write a paper on it. And the teacher was surprisingly very impressed by the not just the writing, but the content of the ideas. So much of what I had studied in Bhagavatam and our shastras was applying directly. It gave me the tools I needed to think about that material that was given at a college level, even though I had never read it before. Shakespeare's Hamlet, for example, Hamlet's story is just like the story of Arjun, in Bhagavad Gita. He's also faced with a family crisis. The crisis also demands that he take violent action against his relatives. He cannot get himself to do it. It ends in a catastrophe at the end, a tragedy. The only difference was that Arjun had Krishna's advice and Hamlet didn't, right? But otherwise, very similar story. So the point is, writing a paper about that, I was going, wow, Shakespeare, here, he's talking about reincarnation. Did anyone notice it? And, the teacher was really happy with it. I remember the Homer's Odyssey. They were always talking about these kings and the Greek, heroes and so on. And every time they'd stop and they'd have a big banquet and meal and drink and so on. And I remember writing an article on the nature of eating and banquets in Homer's Odyssey. And that came all from Caitanya Charitamrita. Because Caitanya Charitamrita, every time something happens, they're all sitting down to take prasadam together. Half the book is about, they went here, they went there, they danced 1 hour in kirtan, and then they had sat down and took prasadam together. And there was rice and this and that, and six types of ingredients here, and then there's a long list, 20 items, and then it goes on, they went, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu walked for some more time, did more kirtan, and then there was prasad. And then, so the point being is that the ability to think philosophically, to think intellectually, culturally, emotional maturity, all of that is found there in the shastras, in Prabhupada's books. And what today's educators and what today's employers are looking for are those kinds of skills. Like Mataji was saying earlier, it's not the facts and figures they're looking for, right? That you've memorized so much information, you know what's right, what's wrong. Because that all will change, right? By the time the kids grow up, if they learn this many facts, well, getting facts is not today's issue, right? Acquiring information is not the problem of our age. The problem of our age is exactly the opposite. We've got way too much information, way too much data on our hands, and among the top 10 skills that employers are looking for today, just recently I was attending one of this at the Career Center for our majors at the university, and like number 3 or 4 was how to process data. How to analyze it, how to make sense of it, how to evaluate it, how to prioritize it. Those are the skills they're looking for. And that's exactly what Bhagavatam is teaching. You see, all of these books, they're all conversations, all dialogues. When do you hear Arjun saying, oh Krishna, whatever you said, wow, that was a scary universal form, I guess I'm going to do what you said. Does he ever say that? Krishna cannot scare him into doing anything. Arjun is very intelligent. He always asks Krishna. He says, Krishna, what you were saying here, that's a contradiction. I don't understand. Beginning of chapter 3, he says. Then chapter 5, he repeats the same thing over. He says, Krishna, I'm still confused. You're still contradicting yourself. Krishna tries again. The entire Bhagavatam is like that also. Right? So it's not valuing blind learning. It's not religious education in the way we think of religion from India. Beta, baith ke karo, chup chap karo. Nahi, don't tell me any. Don't ask me any questions. Just do it. It's good for you. This is not what Bhagavatam is teaching at all. So Prabhupada, he sharpened the intelligence of his disciples by using Bhagavatam. This is what he wanted our kids to do as well. And the benefit of that is by doing this. Why with Bhagavatam? Why not with the Hamlet? And why not with the Odyssey? It's because by studying Bhagavatam, it will transform their character. By associating with Bhagavatam, they'll become wonderful devotees of the Lord. Krishna will there. It says, Krishna svadhamo pagate dharma jnanadi visa. That when Krishna left this world, he came back to this world in the form of Srimad Bhagavatam. This is directly Krishna himself. So we're putting our children in direct association of Krishna. How can there be any problem with that? And how can there be any loss? Krishna says, I am the intelligence of the intelligent. So we put our children in direct association with Krishna. They will turn out to be great devotees of the Lord. At the same time, they will also end up being very successful materially. It's a win-win situation. And therefore, right from the start, as soon as children can read, we need to read with them Srimad Bhagavatam. And my mother is going to talk about some of the techniques how to do that now. After we finish Bhagavatam, because this is the heart of our thing, so just as soon as we want to raise questions on Bhagavatam.
Okay. Another 5 minutes.
Yeah.
So now we understand that children, they get restless and you can't sit with them on long hours of reading Bhagavatam. So what I would do is we would sit in a circle with my two boys and we would just read translations. In other words, we would take turns reading translations. And this way the mind was focused more. And we would stop in between for discussion. In other words, some places the discussion would be longer, in other places shorter. And then one point would lead to another point, and we found ourselves discussing many things, you know, either something to do with the story, you know, thinking deeper about the story or with our practical life or things around, like I said, in the world. And sometimes when there would be questions from them and or realizations, we would not be able to answer those questions, and that's when we would draw into the purpose, we would read the purpose. I would try to read a few purpose ahead of time, so I was a little bit well prepared, but many times I wouldn't get the time. But it's always helpful to do that, and we could take them, you know, deeper into this. And gradually they develop a taste for the reading purpose also. So discussion is a very powerful way of teaching, you know, discussion. Because it really, opens up the mind, you know, when you discuss something. And we know how the whole Bhagavatam was done by discussion, you know, Shaunaka Rishi with all the sages. It was in the mode of discussion. And it's a very powerful method because, like I said, it you end up, you know, with many, many skills. And some of these skills I want to, read to you some of these advantages of this discussion mode of teaching. That today, even today in some universities around the world, like Cambridge and Oxford, they actually have this tutorial system of teaching where one teacher with a few students and they are constantly talking. Today, in today's school, we simply have a monologue where the teacher is talking and the students are listening. And this is really like a one-way thing which doesn't really bring out the best in the children. So I thought I'll just read to you some of these points where... Prabhupada's books help with all aspects of the language arts, namely composition, comprehension, vocabulary, as well as critical and analytical thinking and reasoning. The parents can bring in their own realizations and instill finer points of the philosophy in a way understandable to the children. Then, for example, I would, when I was reading the Prahlad story, and there were so many times when I would discuss with them, you know, there was a point where it talks about how Prahlad was sitting on the lap of his father, Hiranyakashipu, and there were tears streaming down his face, and he was crying. And it made me wonder, you know, here is a father who genuinely has so much affection for his son, he's crying. So what is this? I mean, he also loves his child. So is this real love? So I brought that topic, you know, that subject up, and I asked the children, so here, Hiranyakashipu, the next moment he was ready to kill his son. So is this real love? You know, so that made them think, okay, what is real love? So we discussed how, you know, real love is totally unselfish, the way Krishna loves us. In other words, we are not, it's completely, just like a father, if we love our father, then we can love our brothers and sisters. So if you love Krishna, then we can love each other. In other words, a father can have pure love for his children, as long as he dovetails it to Krishna. Okay. So this kind of brings out some things where we can take a simple thing like that and start discussing. Where Prahlad talks about the equality of all living entities, humans, animals. You know, we can talk about how, you know, all these, everybody, you know, has a spirit soul. And then I raise the question, okay, so animals are also equal. So can we embrace a tiger? You know, he's also a spirit soul. They said, no. So why we cannot embrace? Because... You know, we are all spirit souls, but Prabhupada said we should avoid the people who are envious and too materialistic. We avoid their company, even though we have compassion for them. So things like that, you know, we can bring up. And one time we had I have a little group of children who are all the way from 4 to 10 years old, and I teach them Srimad Bhagavatam, and we were discussing about the difference between a living and non-living entity. And so I asked them, and one child said, the difference is that one living entity moves and the other doesn't move. Okay, yeah, that's good. So I asked them, well, what is it that makes the living entity move? And he said, one child said, legs. So I said, well, earthworms don't have legs. So his another child said, bones. And it was genuine. I mean, they actually, you know, you're trying to teach them the, you know, where does, you know, life, where what gives life. And the other child said, bones. Well, I said, earthworms don't have bones, like that. Or snakes don't have bones. And this way we went through all the different parts of the body to find out what is it that gives the ability to move and gives life, till they actually eventually realized that, okay, it's not the hair, it's not the stomach, it's not all these things, but it's actually the spirit soul that gives life. So things like that, we can make a child think. You know, when we come to a certain part of the Bhagavatam, we can actually expand it and bring. And so the whole key is to play the devil's advocate, you know, where you're always questioning the child in a way that the child is challenged. And if your child is small, you can question in a way his ability to understand. And as he gets older, the, you know, the challenge becomes more deeper and more challenging, like that. And this is where you see in Bhagavatam how Prabhupada is the, you know, uses the you know, certain things called analogies and metaphors. He uses them for us to understand these abstract concepts that Radhika was talking about. How you can take, because we are so conditioned, we don't have the ability to understand spiritual concepts. He uses analogies to help us understand. This whole analogy of the difference between the body and soul being compared to the car and the driver, how Prabhupada uses that. And that makes a child, you know, when the child does these analogies again and again, you know, and it's at different levels. Some analogies are very easy. You know, for example, how Prabhupada compares himself to a mailman delivering, you know, delivering the letter unopened and things like that. Some of them, the concept of, you know, the changing body, you know, how we change our shirts, but we really don't change. All these things look so simple and we take them for granted, but it's helping the child think and reason and think deeper about these things. So they become very, and these are the things that, again and again, and as a child grows older, it becomes harder and harder for the child, you know, to understand. So, and by repeating it, but constant repetition, the child is able to understand these. Like Mataji was saying, how do you discern? I mean, it's like when you grew up with these things in the book, then you actually learn this ability to reason. You're going to school, but you don't take everything blindly. Your peer pressure becomes less of a problem. Because you understand through Prabhupada's books why we are like this, why we don't do things like that. You have good reason why you're a vegetarian. You're just not doing it because your parents are doing it. And they're able to withstand all these, you know, things, you know, this pressure that they get in schools.
And this can start right from the beginning. When they start reading, they can start reading Srimad Bhagavatam. We have children in Boise, 6-7-year-old girls, and they come to Bhagavatam class, we have them read the translation and the purport. At that age, they're reading English of that level. But it's so nice because they may not understand everything, but just by the process of doing it, they're picking up some things. And then, of course, the adults have to simplify it for them so that they can understand. As they grow older, Bhagavatam feeds their intelligence. As children grow older, they need to know why. They, especially in their teenage years, then everything needs to be clear. They have to understand things. The intelligence becomes so active at that point. And if they have an attachment to Bhagavatam at that age, then they'll remain as devotees. Otherwise, it'll start looking like, oh, this is all, you know, sentimentalism, my parents' religion, I'm embarrassed by it, I don't want to do. So Bhagavatam is really important for cultivating the intelligence in Krishna consciousness and helping the intelligence to surrender to Krishna. And the key of that process, like my mother said, is the discussion method. Sometimes, especially coming from an Indian background, we can have the tendency to lecture to our children and then we have, now read this and I give you 10 questions afterwards and answer those questions. So that becomes what? Reading assignment and examination format. They've done many studies that kind of method produces this much result. Active learning, in which the child is actually involved in the process of learning, produces this much result. And the tutorial learning, where the child is actually an equal partner in driving the discussion. So it's not just you asking the questions, the children are also asking the questions. That produces a result where 98% of the children educated in that method are above average in their learning, right? So it's that method which not only is effective, but it also keeps things interesting at the same time for the child. Sometimes they ask questions that you don't know the answer to, and that's okay. Right? There's no problem with that. Means then, oh, we don't know. Look, this is something we should, let's look at the purport to try to see if we can understand. Or maybe we'll get the answer a few verses down. Or let's think about it and you can come up with that discussion later on. Have it during dinner. Discuss it with the other members of the family. Right? So it becomes something that you're fully involved in and engaged in, rather than here's a reading and make sure you answer the questions at the end. At this point, we're out of time for this first session. What we're going to do is, because we really want to make sure that you get this idea of Srimad Bhagavatam nicely, at the beginning of the next session, we'll begin with question and answers, specifically relating to the study of Bhagavatam. If you have any further questions, we'll give about 10, 15 minutes for that, and then we'll continue on with the final portion. The rest of our seminar. We've got more to cover in the books are the basis section, other subjects like music and mathematics and stuff like that. So we'll do that, and then we have the social life part. And those two things we're going to cover after we get back, okay? But we'll start off with question and answers at the beginning of the next session. Thank you all very much for your continuous, undivided attention for this long period. Really appreciate it, and have wonderful prasad, and we'll come and see you soon after part two.
Hare Krishna, keep your big hand. So thank you very much for the first session. So we'll have prasadam now. It will be served outside. We'll be served outside, but you can have here. But just make sure that time management is also good management. 1:25, so we should wrap it up by 2:05, so that we'll have time to clean it up and etc. So please, all the kids are fed already, so please get your prasadam. So let's sing the prasadam prayer before we move. Mahaprasade Govinde, Namo Brahmane Vaishnave, Salpa Punya Badam Rajan, Vishwasanaiva Jayate, Sarira Vidyajal, Jodendriya Tahe Kal, Jive Phele Vishay Sagare, Tar Madhye Jivati, Lobhamaya Sudurmati, Taka Jeta Kathina Sansare, Krishna Bada Dayamaya, Karivare Jivajaya, Saprasadanna Dilobhai, Sehyanna Amrita Pao, Sri Sri Radha Krishna Gunagao, Premedako Sri Chaitanya Nitai, Jani Mai Janitai, Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya, Prabhu Nityananda, Sri Advaita Gadadhara, Srivasadi Gaur Bhakta Brinda, Hare Krishna Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna Hare Hare, Hare Rama Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare Hare, Mahaprasadam ki. One last note, those who have not paid the money, please see Vishakha Mataji, she is there. And please make sure that you get sign and provide your email to get the handouts in email, etc. Hare Krishna.
Before the end of us, you know.
but she read it with us. She would read the chapter a little bit in advance. She would see what's there, and then she would teach them. So you can still read Bhagavatam with your kids, even if you haven't read. You read, just read it with them.
Yeah. Even I was in some kind of doubt with myself only.
Then you have to attend classes in the temple. You need to read, study Bhagavatam yourself thoroughly, get association to teachers. That's important. You have to be practicing Krishna consciousness yourself. Yes. Then only you can give it to your children. So just try to continue with the process. Those core problems we all have. Everyone has some kind of problems in their nature and their character. So we just have to go on with our process of Krishna consciousness nicely. And ultimately all of these things will go. It will just take some time. Just Prabhupada said, you just go on with the process. Continue chanting, continue reading, continue associating with devotees. We should remember that Krishna needs every kind of devotee. Every kind of nature, every kind of personality, Krishna wants us to be devotees. He wants every kind. He doesn't want one category of devotees, one type of devotees. He needs everything. So whatever your nature is, that's fine. You be satisfied with it, happy with it, be proud of it, and just try to use it in Krishna's service. That's all. And then continue in your devotional service. All these things will get worked out.
If I want to go to India, I never see this kind of institution.
You can find it in India. It's there. It's there.
And I'm staying in Hyderabad.
There's very nice community. My mother can give you some references of devotees there.
Yeah, very because nice. I need you if you see the non-devotees or anything, way of especially when you see the name, especially when you have seen the human side. Because if the devotees of the women, the nation is very different. And if the women, if non-devotees of women, because the typical women's mentality is very unbelievable. Because sometimes they will be very smartness, and sometimes they will be very awesome, and sometimes, especially way of talking, especially they want something to catch up on.
You can discuss with my mother these things. She'll be better.
I'll
wrap up for Prasadna, and then otherwise we'll miss the time for Prasadna. Okay. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Sure.
I feel bad to have to ask, so I don't want to ask in front of you.
Sure.
But, have you ever encountered any families who have different standards, something like eating prasad, worked one working parent, one stay-at-home parent, and there's different honoring of prasad?
No, it's the thing is that Krishna is not fanatical, and the thing is, we have to know what the ultimate goal is, and then at the same time we have to be satisfied doing to the best of our ability. So the point is that whatever
it is. Everyone has their particular standard. The example I gave of, you know, going to the...
The
example I gave of going to the because I'm eating food that has been cut. Thank you. That's been cut. I've also cut meat and served on plates like that. So I mean to say that this is something that I have taken as my personal compromise because I'm working on my mental. I can't sit there with an empty plate. I need to do something. So I found that as my level. For someone else, I know other devotees who would never touch even food like that. So what I mean to say is that we need to find our standard and we need to stick with that standard. And then continue to try to do it. That's the secret. That we find a standard that we can maintain and stick to that. If it's, okay, I just can't give up eating bread, no karmi, separate, I made that standard, suppose. Then, okay, I know that's my standard, stick to it strictly, and follow that, no compromises on my standard. But then I know, ultimately, I have to give up the bread too. Right? And this is where I have to reach out. Yeah, most, 90%, 99% broth. As if you read mono and diet it's basically a product of cow, some kind of enzyme that comes from.
I know about enzymes and cheese.
Yeah, it's there. It's there in my bread. It's there in just about every kind of product, mono and diet glycerin. It's an emulsifier. It helps me stick to this. You can find bread without it. But it's very expensive. It's like freshly bred without it, you can find it. But it's like, it would be more like $4 a loaf. So all of a sudden, then making your own bread, your bread machine sounds a lot cheaper. To measure everything, stick it there and separate it.
But you can also discuss because you can present it in a way that they can understand. Anything you can take, anything from the Bhagavatam you can take, because it's your child, you'll be able to present it in a way the child can understand.
Okay, you know, we have some. So, yeah. So we
have yeah.
But it doesn't even have to be a difference of opinion. Then in agreement for our children, this is the type of
thing.
What is your name?
It can have good cake.
I'm just going to use the extra real cake.
Thank you very much for taking your time.
No, thank you for having me.
Yeah, it's almost finished. The first is we have 25 more copies, so people are at home. Yeah. The big.
We are compiling it together. Yanto 1 curriculum. We're going to try to do all of it. You can give it a try. You're gonna miss the chance of it. Why don't you bring your plate and then you can ask me more.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna.
Amma.
I want to say something in the morning. Hare Krishna, we're going to have a puppet show in the middle unit. Krishna. Hare Krishna. Books are the busy. Hare Krishna.
Amma, how do we turn this off?
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Krishna. Hare. Hare. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Krishna Krishna. Hare Hare. Hare Rama. Hare Rama. Rama Rama. Hare Hare.
I'm shy.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.